Let us pray. Almighty God, we who have called us to govern this province, we ask your help to make decisions and laws that will be just and will promote the interests of the people. Almachtige God, ons bid dat u gedurende ons vergaderings ons die nodige wysheid sal gee en ons motiewe suiwer sal hou en dat u ons sal help om ons tekortkominge te oorkom en al ons besluite aan u op te dra. Sikelela lesweletu na bantu balo umisili ukulungu kwipondo letu. Kosa sikeleli I Afrika, kina bantwana bayo, kokela in kokeli zayo, iniki ukolo I Afrika. All this we beg in your holy name, amen. Please be seated. Good morning, goeiemôre, Molweni. I would like to take this opportunity to welcome our guests in the gallery. Please be assured that we appreciate your presence here, but we also want to draw your attention to the fact that our guests cannot participate in the proceedings of the House, and that includes clapping of hands, heckling, and interjection. To the members, good morning. We have a full speakers list today. It's a pretty full program, and I would like to ask up front that I ensure the members' cooperation in trying to make sure that the sitting goes through as smoothly as possible. Thank you. The secretary will read the order of the day.
Debate on Premier's State of the Province Address.
I have received a copy of the Premier's State of the Province Address delivered in the House on Friday. The address is printed in the minutes of the proceedings, and I now place it in the House for the debate. I see the Honourable Leader of the Opposition, the Honourable Mngaka.
Thank you, Honourable Speaker. The Honourable Premier of the Western Cape, Honourable Members, distinguished guests, and my dear comrade, most importantly, the people of the Western Cape. Madam Speaker, this debate takes place during a painful time for workers in our country, with three mine workers of whom two is women, Yvonne Mnisi, Pretty Mabuza, and Solomon Nyerenda, painfully trapped underground at Lilly's Gold Mine. Today marks day 18 of this tragic experience. We stand in solidarity with their loved ones and pray for their successful rescue. On behalf of the black poor majority of the Western Cape, we rise as an African National Congress to convey their plight, hopes, and aspiration for a Western Cape where they are equal citizens. At our 53rd National Conference in Mangaung, we resolved that the main content of the ANC National Democratic Revolution remains the liberation of Africans in particular and the blacks in general from political and socio-economic bondage. This means uplifting the quality of life of all South Africans, especially the poor, the majority of whom are Africans and female. At the same time, it has the effect of liberating the white community from the false ideology of racial supremacy and insecurity attached to oppressing others. At our annual January the 8th celebration held in Rustenburg earlier this year, we declared 2016, I quote, the year of advancing people's power, placing active citizenry at the center of our society's development, close quote. This declaration reaffirms our commitment as a liberation movement to uplifting the lives of our people through active engagement in democratic processes. It is also a clear indicator that the ANC places our people at the center of governance and the development of a non-racial, non-sexist, truly democratic society. South Africa remains a unitary state and envisage a Western Cape which is in line with our national objective as a country. The Western Cape is of our 9 provinces. Its success are the successes of South Africa as a whole, and its challenges are those of the rest of South Africa. We can only have a united South Africa when we have a united Western Cape. Therefore, the heightened inequality we currently face between racially divided classes, which perpetuate sexism, must be directly attributed to the Democratic Alliance Provincial Government. Our strategic objective of attaining a national democratic society will never be realized under the current condition. The DA government is politically and ideologically opposed to these ideals of equality, ideals that many of our icons died for. Premier, your painful long speech last Friday, unfortunately, was uninspiring, petty, and filled with untruth and opportunism, and quite frankly, lacked leadership vision and based on your own imaginary. We expected to hear the Premier of the Western Cape speaking about how she and her government plan to uplift the lives of the poor majority of this province. Instead, we had a former or perhaps a leader of the Democratic Alliance who continues to lead from the grave, providing us petty anecdotes of how great the DA is. In fact, what we received on Friday was not a state of the province address, but rather the state of DA address. Madam Premier, as I sat here and listened to your speech, the one thing which became abundantly clear is that the government you lead and the political party you represent poses a real danger to unity and equality in this province and indeed the country. White privilege and racial prejudice runs through every paragraph, sentence, including full stop of your address. I sat in disgust at the discriminative comments you made, all whilst your colleague sat laughing. Oddly enough, even those honorable members of the DA who experienced racial discrimination in the province joined their colleagues in laughing. Let me share one particular disgusting rant you made, and I quote, "A library in Khayelitsha has the highest book outtake in the country. Can you believe it?" Close quote. Premier, you then repeated this comment as if to further prove how racial ideology and discrimination has embedded itself in your outlook. I would like to ask Madam Premier, what exactly is so unbelievable? Is it the fact that black people actually can and do read? Or is it the fact that a library which barely has any resources due to the skewed allocation of funds in this province is actually excelling, or perhaps even both? In fact, Madam Premier, I think I am being too harsh on you. Surely I am expecting too much from someone who believes that poor black people migrating from other provinces are refugees. At the forefront of increasing racial tension, bigotry, and exploitation of the poor in the province is the government you lead, Premier. In this regard, you cannot put the culpability of increasing racial and class inequality at the doorstep of President Jacob Zuma, the ANC, and mythical destabilization campaign. In fact, the instability of this province is a campaign engineered by you and the backward ideologues sitting opposite to the ANC branches, those who are howling and dumping now. This mindset
accusing the Premier of a criminal act is not
order,
permissible.
Please, members.
Accusing a Premier of being an architect of instability is accusing of a criminal act, and that is unparliamentary.
Your point has been noted. Order, please, Honourable Davids. You may proceed, Honourable Mgaka.
In fact, the instability of this province is a campaign engineered by you and the backward ideologues sitting opposite the ANC benches. This mindset has been developed through a premier who cannot hide her ideological and subjective disposition of poor black people as an other or a racial other. An other which is not expected to be able to read and have an appreciation for the accumulation of knowledge, because this other is subhuman, and their assimilation to human status is something which is unbelievable and worthy of special recognition. The children of Khayelitsha, according to the Premier, must continue to live in conditions of squalor, exclusion, inferiority, economic oppression, and exploitation. The DA, through every utterance, every policy, every action, has come to optimize white patriarchal racism. Honorable Speaker, do these characteristics not remind you of a certain government of the past that the ANC dislodged? We all witnessed the bus John moment John Steenhuisen had in the National Assembly last Wednesday, when he stood up and told an elderly African male that he is talking rubbish. This does not surprise us. The bus mentality is very rife in the Democratic Alliance. All one has to do is observe behavior of the DA Chief Whip, Honorable Mike Wiley, to witness bus mentality at play. I don't know if she remembers, but shortly before crossing the floor to the DA, Patricia de Lille accused the DA of the same bus cap mentality. She might have forgotten now that she has assimilated the bus status, assuming that she has, of course. In the recent weeks, we have seen a spike in racist attacks. One would have imagined that a premier of a province which remains as racially segregated as the Western Cape will come out strongly on such issues. However, there was no mention of any plan for social integration, social cohesion, and fighting racism in her address. Black students and institutions of higher learning in the Western Cape remain targets of racist attacks. Black women are beaten up for just walking the white street of the southern suburb, where our premier comes from. The Dinah Kola Banadis and Penny Sparrows of the DA proves that the Democratic Alliance harbors people that last over the past and continuously entrench the oppressive status quo through any means at their disposal. The premier said that she dedicates the SOPA and the remaining 3 years of her premiership to the youth, which is welcome. She said that Cape Town has become a magnet for young people. I wonder which young people she's referring to, because young black professionals are actually leaving the city of Cape Town due to racism. If the city of Cape Town is a magnet for anything, it is a magnet for racism.
Please take your seat. I'm sorry. Please take your seat. Members, I need to request your cooperation, both sides of the floor. We have a speaker, and your ongoing little debate is drowning the speaker out. So please just tone it down a little bit, please. You may proceed, Honorable Mgaka.
If the city of Cape Town is a magnet for anything, it is a magnet for racism. All you have to do is ask any young black professional of their experience of seeking accommodation in the city of Cape Town or entering a restaurant on Upper Clove Street. The very same young people she dedicates her status of the DA to have actually become unemployed under her watch. Youth jobs under the DA are at their lowest they have ever been in the last 10 years. Let's go to the statistics. In 2006, youth jobs were at 934,000. By 2012, this figure fell to 844,000. At the end of the year 2014, there were about 856,000 youth jobs in the Western Cape. This therefore means that 78,000 young people were no longer in employment in the Western Cape by the end of 2014, because the premier selectively quoted unemployment numbers. Quoted employment numbers. Let me provide the real numbers of youth jobs in the Western Cape. In quarter two of 2015, 5,000 more young people became unemployed in the Western Cape. 21,000 young people became employed between 2009 and end 2014. Perhaps the Premier should dedicate her last 3 years of premiership to those 21,000 young people who have lost their jobs under her watch. The Premier has a long history of being anti-youth. Her track record as a mayor in the city of Cape Town proved this. One of the first things she did as a mayor of city of Cape Town was to close down the youth council. Yes. The office of the Premier of the Western Cape is the only one in the country which does not support the National Youth Development Agency. Yes. The question I must ask,
order.
My dear Premier, is why are you anti-youth? Or is it your problem with black youth, rather, or black female youth in particular? Perhaps we should ask Lindiwe Mazibuko or Mbali Ntuli, whom the Premier pushed out of the DA vehemently and aggressively. Let us look at the Western Cape's job story. The Premier boasted about how the unemployment rate of the Western Cape was down to 20.6 in September 2015 from 24.8 in 2012. However, what the Premier selectively failed to mention is that in 2009, she inherited a province with an unemployment rate of 19.9%, which was the lowest in the country when she took over. This therefore means that the unemployment rate went up under the premiership of Helen, Zille and her alliance. When comparing the unemployment in the Western Cape with that of other provinces, KwaZulu-Natal has decreased their official unemployment rate by 3.6% and their expanded unemployment rate by 5.2% for the year ending September 2015. KwaZulu-Natal had the second highest job gains by 1,058,000, following Gauteng with 191,000 jobs for the year ending September 2015. Nationally, 15.3 million people are now employed, the highest yet in our economy history. This proves that the notion that the Western Cape under the DA is the best run province remained a myth fueled by deliberate misinformation on the part of the DA's propaganda. While jobs have grown in the Western Cape, the racial composition of these jobs are in line with the DA's core mandate of preserving white privilege and entrenching racial and economic inequalities. Job creation in the Western Cape continues to benefit white people. The latest employment equity report shows that 63.8% of top management positions in the Western Cape are occupied by white males, while only 2% are occupied by African males. White females occupied 14% of the top management position, while African females occupied just 1% of top management position in the province. When compared to other provinces, the Western Cape has the highest percentage of top and senior management posts occupied by white people, as expected under the DA leadership. Now, the Premier states that there are over 200 more jobs in the Western Cape than there were when she came into office, but she, however, selectively failed to tell us who the bulk of those jobs went to. While white South Africans made up of up to 16% of Western Cape residents of working age in 2014, they benefited from 57% of total job growth in the province from 2009 up to 2014. Africans made 32% of the working population of the province, but just got 16% of the jobs. This is but one example of a government hell-bent on entrenching racialized economy. DA is a racist party. It is also rather interesting that the Premier speak about 200,000 jobs from 2009 to 2014 because the DA promised South Africans 6 million jobs in their election manifesto in 2014. What then becomes of the other 5.8 million jobs? Surely those only exist Park Umnumzana, Umayman, is Enhlokweni Kuwe. The Premier speaks about the slow growth rate of the economy nationally and blame the slow growth in the Western Cape on national wage increase. Her attack on the national wage increase of 7.2% proves that the Premier and the DA has a role of anti-decent wages. Their labour policy, which is anti-union and anti-collective bargaining, proves that the right of workers to decent wage, collective bargaining and protection are things the Democratic Alliance are opposed to. This is a bourgeois party. The Premier even has the audacity to propose the capping of wage increases to 5.5%, while the current inflation rate for year-end 2015 is only 5.2%, which means that lower-income workers will barely be able to survive and afford basic goods and services such as food and transport. This is yet another example of a provincial administration determined to preserve class divisions and worker exploitation. The triple crisis of poverty, unemployment, and inequality remains a huge challenge for South Africa. We are pleased that in this State of the Nation Address, President Zuma did not shy away from the fact that South Africa will face economic challenges in the year ahead, as South Africa does not exist in a vacuum, but is affected by global economic trends. In staying true to her character, the Premier didn't fail to remind us that Western Cape's economic growth rate is higher than national average because she is consistent competing and not partnership with our national government. What the Premier failed to mention was that over the past 10 years, the economic growth rate of the Western Cape has always been higher than the national average. Except for 2012, where the national average was 3% and the provincial average stood at 2.6%. Over the last 6 years, the Western Cape economy has not grown above a 3% average, with 2012 and 2013 being the most devastating on the economy of the province. The reality of the matter is that our economy nationally has been facing difficulties since the financial crisis in 2008, and government at a national level has done fairly well in stabilizing a very volatile situation. We take note of the 9-point plan as presented by President Jacob Zuma, which we believe will make a difference. I am pleased that the Premier made mention of the fire season, which is currently upon us, as we know that it is poor black majority who are affected by these fires. It is, however, unfortunate that while congratulating firefighters, correctly so, for their hard work done, the Premier failed to mention the displaced people of Ward 89 in Khayelitsha, who were displaced by fires on the 1st January 2013. Just imagine, 2013, and remained there till today. She failed to mention the people of SST in Site B, who had to erect their shacks without any assistance from this government. While she correctly applauded the firefighters, she conveniently forgot the 9 innocent lives lost in December 2015 due to fires. She forgets the people of Masipumelele, deliberately forgetting Imizamo Yetu, Hengbeg, Khayelitsha, and countless of other poor communities continue to reside in complete destitution and hopelessness. Apart from obvious misinformation presented by Premier to this House on Friday, her speech was also filled with glaring broken promises. In 2012, the Premier promised that by 2014, 70% of government facilities and every school shall be connected to broadband and ICT access in every ward. We are now in 2016, and this remains to be seen. The Josta Hospital, which we promised will be reconstructed in 2013, has since been closed down by this government. This is in line with the DA believing that poor black people do not deserve quality health care, as DA MP James Wilmot said, the national health insurance is a Rolls Royce in the sauna debate last week, meaning that black people don't deserve a Rolls Royce. I was rather taken aback when the Premier announced her plans to conduct a study moving administrative capital of South Africa to Cape Town. She mentioned proposal for a public-private partnership to locate major government administration buildings and parliamentary resident accommodation in the proximity of 3 hectares available for development to our current parliament. One wonders why these plans were not explored when we call for inner city migration through making space available for low-cost housing for the working class who work in the city. The fact of the matter is that the Premier and her government simply refused to provide affordable housing. The provincial government has instead chosen to sell public land perfectly suited for housing to investors with no strings attached, madam. Last week, we learned that Public Works MEC Donald Grant has given notice that four prime sites are up for sale in the CBD, with a combined development potential of 300,000 square meters or 30 rugby fields, according to that paper. The first of which, the old Tafelberg Remedial School in Sea Point, has already been sold to a wealthy private individual. There, the opportunity to build 216 mixed income affordable units has already been lost. We also learned that for the other three sites, the province proposes mixed use development similar to the old biscuit mill in Woodstock, with space for exclusive apartment targeting investors and tourists. This is an elite land captured for exclusive use by the already privileged rich, who are by and large white. The billions of rand invested into the province by private sector should again not be presented as a social or economic advances by the Western Cape government. The poor of the province will never see a cent of the billions of this investment. Most major private sector corporate social investment only comprise of a minuscule amount of profit they reap and only stretch the surface of poor communities where the private sector secure their workplace. The Premier also failed to present a comprehensive plan to support and develop informal sector economy. The provincial government present us with a narrative that the private sector alone will resolve all our employment challenges. Again, not realizing that many, mainly African, workers are forced to make a living in the informal sector economy due to historical disadvantages that marginalizes poor people in a hostile atmosphere. Further, the billions brought in from the surge in tourism find little economic benefit in the workers in the industry. If anything, Madam Premier, your speech was an absolute joke, an insult to the people of the Western Cape, including to you, by the way, if you want to transform this country. You have proven yet again that instead of working with national government, you've chosen to fight it. You know that. Instead of meaningfully uplifting the lives of the poor majority, you entrench a racialized economy which benefit white people. In your place, Madam Honorable Chefa, one of the most reactionary people I ever come across in this house.
No. Order,
instead
please.
Of meaningful uplifting the lives
Honorable
of the poor
Ngaka,
majority.
Please take your
can
seat.
I finish that?
Sorry, there's a point of order. Please take your seat.
I would like to
Honorable
rise on a point of order, Speaker, that you do not cast aspersion on the member sitting in this house, and the member is out of order.
Thank you, Honorable Makrosela. Honorable Mgaka, if I can address you, I heard you saying that the member Schaefer is the most reactionary of the lot. It is casting an aspersion on an individual who is present in the house. If you could refrain from that, I'd appreciate it. Thank you.
Yes, can you educate me about the wrongness of the word?
Yeah.
Can you educate me about the wrongness of the word reactionary?
You may proceed, Honorable Ngaka,
okay.
Just for noting.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. In my conclusion, I want to mention this again. Instead of meaningful uplifting the lives of the poor majority, you entrench a racialized economy. Instead of fighting racism, you have institutionalized it. And some people see it as a culture of the Western Cape. As the African National Congress and the people of the Western Cape, we reject your so-called State of the Province address, which to us is about just demonstrating how weak your governance is. Thank you, Madam.
Thank you, Honorable Ngaka. Order, please, members. I can answer that question. I have received an apology from the Honourable Fransman, so may we proceed. Minister Fritz, I see the Honourable Minister.
Thank you, Honourable Speaker. I want to start off by saying that the content of, and I'm not going to call anyone the leader because I think it's the Secretary of, the General Secretary of the South African Communist Party, on behalf of the ANC that he made the speech today. And order, I want please. To say it is interesting
Honourable
that
Fritz,
the
if you
Honourable...
Could take your seat, please. Is it a point of order?
It's a point Honourable of order, Chair, Speaker.
Yes.
The leader of opposition has been announced to your office.
Correct.
And I want to plead to you that every member in this House, please respect our leader of opposition. Yes. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. You may proceed, Minister Fritz.
Then I will call it the acting leader of, because I can't remember you've been elected as the leader. I just want to also echo the acting leader of the Honourable Opposition. I want to echo, where was he elected? Poor Marius Fransman.
Members, Honourable Members, order please.
I just want to also echo the words and the message of support and strength to the mine workers who are trapped underground on behalf of this government, the DA government in the Western Cape. And we are our sincere concern at this point, and we know the difficult time they're going through. I want to say, Honourable, and I know I have a sweeper, but I am so tempted, I can't help not saying something. That
order, please.
The Honourable okay. Acting, the Honourable Acting
order.
Leader of the Opposition speaks
order.
All the time. He's the one who made the point that we are the ones who are dividing people on class lines. He speaks only of the African workers. What about the colored workers? What about the white workers? What about Indian workers in this province?
Order, please.
And when I, he racializes the working class.
Honorable Fritz,
he makes
Minister,
the class
please,
issue.
Please take your seat. Members, we have a far way to go, and we cannot have members shouting across at the speaker, and similarly both sides of the House. We cannot drown out a speaker on the floor. Member, Honourable Davids, I'm not singling you out, but you are the first one to launch into the speaker. If you don't mind, interjection is allowed, but you cannot do an ongoing commentary. Asseblief mense, kan ons net 'n bietjie bedaar. Let's try and maintain the dignity and decorum of the House, and let's try and get through the sitting without all these interruptions. You may proceed, Honourable Minister.
And so it is interesting that the ANC constantly accuses the DA of race and being racist, and they have nothing else. I listened to that speech, it's hollow. He calls the Premier's speech a joke. I think that was the biggest joke. The acting Honourable Leader of the Opposition. And so the point I want to make, there was nothing of substance in that speech. There was absolutely nothing of content. There's no content in the speech. And all he could say was vague insinuations and aspersions on people in the House. And it leaves me with almost nothing else to say in this speech. But Honourable Speaker, in a sober speech last week, the Premier clearly spelled out the contribution this province, the provincial government is making towards building a capable state. The issue in this House is about whether we have a capable state or not. And let's go through South Africa and let's us go and assess the other countries and let's see whether we have capable states or not.
Minister Fritz,
of
please
course,
address the
greatly
chair.
Pains, this of course greatly pains the ANC that this province has consistently, and we're talking based on evidence, Honourable Speaker, based on evidence, by statistics produced, but not by us, but by the national government itself, that this is the top province in every aspect of governance.
Order, please.
in the tired and unimaginative view of the ANC, all the tremendous growth we have made based on real evidence and statistics can only be reduced to, by them, to race, the poor thing of race. I feel so sorry for everyone else who's not African. Waarom sal dit
order, sê, please.
Ons gee die waarheid terug. Speaker,
Honorable Fritz,
it is the ANC. Sorry.
Please kindly address the chair. Do
Thank
not
you.
Engage Honorable Davids in the debate. Thank you.
Honorable Speaker, the question is, why is it that the ANC is incapable of engaging meaningfully on the key issues as outlined in the Premier's speech? They can't address it. They didn't address one of the issues in the Premier's speech. Speaker, there's a battle of appearances versus reality being waged in this legislature. On the one hand side, the ANC is hell-bent on giving appearances that the province has declined, whereas the reality, on every, based on every piece of evidence, that we have, in fact, increased the performance of this province and the service delivery to the poor in this province. And I think that calls for an amen. Our services as a government are overwhelming skewed towards serving the poor communities. And they know it. The provincial treasury has shown that 76% of our spending goes into the poor through services, jobs, and growing the economy, Honorable Speaker. This benefits poor and the poorest community. And I would one day take them by the hand and lead them to the streets of Van Overpark and Khayelitsha and Mitchell's Plain and take them to some people, some young boys who's been empowered by this province. To date, the ANC have never produced a shred of evidence
Order,
to dispute
please.
This fact. Yet they say, and they serve only the rich. They continue to say that we only serve the rich. This is an ANC delusion, one which has come to characterize the party at large. This is a party of delusions such as those of the National General Secretary Gwede Mataše, who said that the USA are planning a regime change in South Africa through a youth exchange program. Exactly. It is the voters, I want to remind the Honorable House, it is the voters who in this province planned and executed the regime change, and they will never be elected back into power. Never be elected
Order.
Back. The ANC area, never. We can categorically
Minister,
say never.
Please take your seat, Honorable Minister Fritz. Honorable Davids, I am appealing to you. I know you love to get stuck into the debate, but please allow the speaker to present. I'm sure you will have an opportunity, but we cannot allow ongoing commentary. If you don't mind, I'm going to appeal to the Chief Whip. If you could assist, it would be greatly appreciated. Thank you. You may proceed, Honorable Minister.
I want to put it to the House that the contrast couldn't have been greater. Whilst the Premier of this province delivered a speech which inspired confidence, the former leader of the ANC, Marius Fransman, was putting a post on Facebook questioning why his tenure as leader was as rocky and uncertain. With Marius Fransman now joins, and the question is, will he now join the growing coalition of the wounded of the ANC? Or let me guess, it is a choice of deciding whether he'll be a pool thrower or an ambassador somewhere, depending on what he decides. And it's a very startling thing. It shows ANC that's in complete disarray, or an inmate. You know, that's the third option. The state of the province delivered by Honorable Helen Zille left residents of this province with a great sense of hope. We are building a capable state founded on freedom, fairness, and opportunity.
Order,
let me repeat a key fact shared by the Premier last week. The 2015 Public Service Awards, a national ceremony held by the Department of Public Service Administration, saw every gold, silver, and bronze medal coming to this province. It showed every one of them.
Order, and, please.
You know, I want to repeat, every gold, silver, and bronze award nationally for the departments and the heads of departments came to the Western Cape. And thus, they just can't run away. And they can run, but they can't hide. And this is the problem with the ANC over on the other side. Every one of our 13 departments, Honourable Speaker, received a financially unqualified audit outcome, with 12 receiving clean audits. Now, isn't that amazing? And then they call it compliance, compliance. This is unprecedented, because in other provinces, the nearest they come, I think, is 50% or 30%. They're useless, incapable government anywhere else they govern. This is a, yeah. Speaker, the reality is the DA-led Western Cape government,
order, please,
through
members.
Good governance and delivery, is addressing the legacy of racism. One only has to look at the diverse cabinet, and I am proud today to say I'm associated with diverse caucus sitting behind me. It's the only diverse caucus, and I'm very proud to say I'm part of it. Because I used to sit there where it was just one group. Now it's very nice to be in a very diverse group. And this diversity, Honorable Speaker, is not based on bean counting.
Order,
who was useless. We talk about the capabilities of people on this side of the house. And I'm so proud to be part of this house, of this DA government in the Western Cape. Speaker, we are building strong institutions, pockets of excellence, which are extending quality services to the most vulnerable segments of our society. And we will continue to do this. And I want to just for the record say, our government and this house and our departments will assist the Premier in the next 3 years, and she will be in 3 years here. We will assist her to promote, we will continue to promote youth unemployment, youth marginalization, which they neglected youth marginalization. We will continue to empower young people wherever we find them, and we will go look for them and empower them. And they know, a lot of them know, how many of them phone me late at night to ask to empower the
minister,
youth, because they can't even do it.
Honourable Minister, can I ask that you manage your finger, please? I know it's part of your... please do.
In fact, testament to this, the Department of Social Development has over the last 6 years expanded services and brought them closer to communities, Honourable Speaker. My department has moved from one head office overseeing 16 district offices and one head office overseeing an expanded network of 6 regional offices. And now we have 37 local offices where the people are living and where services
are. Honourable Minister, your time has expired. Please finish up.
Thank you, Honourable.
Thank you. Members, can we have some order, please? There's too much noise in the chamber. I see the Honourable Schaefer. You may proceed.
Speaker, we are here today to debate one of the most important issues affecting our citizens, how we plan to build a resilient, inclusive and a competitive space, unlocking and unblocking the growth potential of this Western province. You see, Speaker, national government has failed dismally to really tackle the unjust disparities of our past, and in particular, the economic exclusion where so many South Africans find themselves today. The small insider group of the ANC versus the massive outsiders, the people of South Africa. How are we in the Western Cape providing solutions to changing the disparity that still exists in our country today? It is through the Western Cape's focused economic strategy, which aims to stimulate specific sectors of our economy where the greatest opportunity for jobs and economic growth can occur. Speaker, in the face of the national job crisis, I'm happy to say that the Western Cape is still able to provide more jobs than the rest of the country. According to Stats SA, Member Magaka,
order.
Between 2008 and 2015, the 200,000 new jobs have been created. And in the same period while we
order,
were creating
please.
These new jobs, the unemployment in South Africa has almost risen by 1.2 million people. It is absolutely astounding that President Zuma just yesterday publicly stated that David van Rooyen was the most highly qualified finance minister he has ever appointed. I say the president has absolutely no jobs plan and definitely does not understand the economy. Speaker, because you know what happened after he said that? The rand reacted and once again tumbled. 9/12, the day the rand crashed. You see,
order,
Speaker,
please.
The Western Cape has a jobs plan, a real jobs plan. With Project Kulisa, our focus on tourism, the oil and gas sector, and agri-processing, the Western Cape is well on the track to creating these new jobs.
If you could take your seat, please, members. There's too much noise. We need to just allow the speaker on the floor the opportunity to not be drowned out. I understand heckling and interjection, but we cannot drown a speaker on the floor. You may proceed, Honourable Shaper.
A sign of a province on the right track is when business speaks to the confidence they have in this province. The very 654,000 square metres of commercial and residential
Excuse me, that has been
approved for construction in the past
year. Please take your seat. Honourable Davids, may I address you? I have provided guidance since we started. I have asked you to refrain. An interjection is allowed, but an ongoing commentary becomes disruptive and it affects the flow. So can I please ask you once again to refrain from ongoing commentary? Please, thank you. You may proceed, Honourable
Thank you, Speaker. Schaefer. That's nine times more than Gauteng. I say business confidence in this DA-led province is at an all-time high. Markets react and markets have spoken. Speaker, the Western Cape recognises that youth unemployment requires focused intervention and has developed programs that speak directly to skill development, entrepreneurship and innovation. Capacity, our special purpose vehicle, is a case in point, acting as a bridge between training and employment, guaranteeing that individuals who qualify with the programs are ensured employment in the field they study. Capacity has placed over 96% of all our graduates at over 150 companies since 2011, trained and placed in excess of 600 unemployed youth to date. In 2015, they trained over 200 previously unemployed youth in scarce tech skills, matching them to high-value tech jobs, and another 300 youth are in the project for this year. Capacity specifically develops programs in direct response to industry demand, ensuring that the curriculum covers what we call a real-world work environment, assisting our youth to accessing opportunities, bringing them into the economy, and what an accountable and capable government does. Speaker, and while we've seen some record numbers moving through our Cape Town International Airport this season, South Africa has seen a decline in tourist arrivals of 6.8% for 2015 from 2014. The great numbers seen at the airport were not sufficient to ensure that South Africa maintained a continued growth in tourism for the first time in its history. According to the report by Grant Thornton, because tourism arrivals only grew by 7.5% in 2014, the negative 2015 performance actually has wiped out 2 years' worth of vital tourism growth. That is what the impact of the amended visa regulations has done to a key sector in the Western Cape and South Africa at large. It has taken close to 2 years now for Minister Gigaba's department to bow down to pressure and begin to implement the concessions decided by his cabinet to undo the damage of the regulations. And still, we find a reluctance from him to do so. Minister Patel, in his recent economic speech, stated that his government engages with business and stakeholders on every level. Home Affairs has failed to engage with the tourism sector, failed to listen or heed calls made by the industry, and failed to take our extensive report of the impact of the visa regulations tabled by this parliament seriously. Even trafficking numbers that Minister Gigaba used were thrown out as grossly overstated. Despite this, we took our visa frustration through to the red tape reduction unit, and one by one, we tried to solve them. And instead, we also focused on new markets through the launch of the Western Cape's air access strategy to improve our competitiveness and ease of access into targeted African markets. The proposed upgrade and realignment of the Cape Town International Airport of $3.1 billion will see an increase of new flights by 50%, adding 3,000 additional jobs and unlocking massive economic growth in surrounding areas, the Aerotropolis. This is where the Western Cape has identified the poorest, the youngest, and the most marginalized of communities living. This is where the Western Cape will ensure that the people will benefit from this massive expansion project the most. And Speaker, while the country faces a severe drought, we await for the official proclamation of Central Karoo and the West Coast declared as disaster areas. The Western Cape is financially assisting our emerging grain farmers from risk of failure. On the one hand, the ANC talks about land reform and building an inclusive agricultural sector, and on the other hand, they fail on policy implementation and real land reform in South Africa. The Department of Land Reform has a policy to acquire land called the Proactive Land Acquisition Strategy Plus, where an emerging farmer can access a piece of land for about a 9-year lease. The problem is there's a massive backlog of leases to be issued. The ANC has put people on land with no sustainability, instead acquiring land for itself and no return of land to address the disparities of the past. The land just becomes a liability to the state. Speaker, we in the DA are going to watch the 31st of March 2016 like hawks. The Department of Rural Development and Land Reform has been mandated that all plus farms must have lease contracts in place by then. Not to mention the District Land Committee set up with no budget. This is how serious the ANC is about land reform. Last but not least, my colleague such as Member Dugmore needs to hear this on the other side. No commercial farmer, even if they wanted to, could get involved in land reform, as there's no policy that speaks to this in national government. Yes, they will deny it, but show me the policy and I will make a public apology. No policy exists at all. And finally, Speaker, let the ANC take heed of this quote. Failure isn't fatal, but failure to change just might be. I thank you.
Order. The Honourable Minister, Marika Zille.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Mr. Deputy Speaker, let me take the opportunity to welcome the new leader of the official opposition. And we want to express our gratitude to the ANC for appointing him in his position. We couldn't have asked for a better ally. If his dismal track record as Secretary of the South African Communist Party is anything to go by, then we are sure that he'll do a much better job of destroying the ANC than us. The Honorable Leader of the Opposition spoke about the DA posing danger, but the actual person and the people who are posing the real danger in this province is Honorable Member Magaga and his racist faction within the ANC. Yes, it is my speech. And his racist faction within the ANC. The ANC in this province, Mr. Deputy Speaker, has decided to throw the colored leaders under the bus, which further proves the point that I'm making about the danger that honorable people like Magaga are posing in this province. They are now applying double standards by acting as if they are dealing with these people for the transgressions they caused. But how on earth do you justify a situation where some leaders are dealt with, but a leader like Andile Lili, who has caused so much suffering and pain in this province, still remain the member of the PEC. Now, this shows the double standard.
Order, order.
This really shows the double standard of this party. And really, it must be very, very painful. I know some people will howl. It must really be very painful to be the member of the ANC, who is a colored or a white person. Because what is happening now, Mr. Deputy Speaker, while we try to unite South Africans to deal with the serious issues of racism, it suits the ANC's agenda to divide our people along racial lines. Because the question that we need to ask ourselves here, Mr. Deputy Speaker, is that who stands to benefit by dividing South Africans? Now, if we want to be the party in national government as Democratic Alliance, it really doesn't suit us to divide South Africans along racial lines. We have to rally everyone behind the DA because we want to be the government. But in order for the ANC to remain in power, they must continue dividing our people along racial lines. Now, I'm sure really... Members of other races in the ANC must be feeling like endangered species. And this is very, very serious. We are very much aware that the ANC's strategy, as I said, is to divide South Africans along racial lines in order to maintain in power, resorting to stunts like the march that we've seen when the ANC marched on itself on Friday. This march was, in fact, an admission by the ANC that they failed to lead this country. How on earth can a ruling party call on masses and play victim when it's supposed to provide leadership and come up with challenges that are facing the country? How do we explain that? We also saw 10 remaining members of the ANC in the province marching during SOPA by Premier. It was a sorry state of affairs. If you saw the number of people who decided to march here. Mr. Deputy Speaker, unlike the ANC, we do not deny that racism is one of South Africa's problems that we need to deal with. We do not deny that. And if you've noticed, the party, through our leader, took a stance on this issue. But the truth is, Mr. Deputy Speaker, we must not be denialists. Racists are found everywhere, including in my own party, and we have said that. But there are also racists in the ANC and many other parts of South Africa. So let us not pretend as if the problem of racism and racists only exists this side. Because if we continue to pretend as if it exists elsewhere and not in the party that is leading this country, that is why we'll never be able to deal with this problem. Now, I must also say that, sadly, racism suits the ANC's agenda, as I said, because the ANC has nothing left to offer. They've run out of excuses. So that is why they are now resorting to wetgevaar tactic in order to whip up the emotions of vulnerable and poor South Africans. That's why people like Honorable Member Magaka have been spreading this propaganda about the DA delivering more in white areas. But the irony, Mr. Deputy Speaker, is that no ANC-run province deliver better services in black areas than the DA. Yeah. Now, while he spoke about fiction, let me talk about facts. Because we base our facts on an official report like the Stats SA report. Now, this is the report that is coming from the Stats SA. Now, let me prove to you the point that I'm making here. Number of consumer units receiving water and free basic services from municipalities. The top province out of 9 provinces is Western Cape by 75.7%. And listen to this. And the second province is 41.7%. Now, that's a first indicator. That which shows that this DA government delivers better in poor black areas than any ANC-run province. Number of consumer units receiving electricity and basic electricity services from municipalities in all 9 provinces, top province, Western Cape, by almost 45%, and the second province, a distant 25.7%. Now, these are basic services that are provided to the poor. The third indicator, which is an issue that they normally throw at us, number of consumers receiving sewerage and sanitation and free basic services from municipalities, Western Cape remains the top by more than 69%, and the second province, come at a distant 41.9%. Now, this is a clear indication, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that people can spread lies, but facts don't lie. This report is a state report which shows all the delivery across the provinces. Now, the ANC has no shame Mr. Deputy Speaker. As we have seen in the recent Amatole region toilet saga, that is a classic example of what we mean when we say these people have no shame. Where money that was meant for the poor was embezzled by the elite members of the party and left a small chain to build toilets that pose risks to the poor people. Those toilets broke down in a few months, and these members have an audacity to pretend as if they care about poor people. In many areas, in places like Eastern Cape, people are still relieving themselves in bushes because of similar attitudes and practices. Now, shame on you. Contrary to the picture that is painted about this government, the figures that I spoke about here don't lie. In a State of the Province address, Premier Helen Zille shared the progress made on our game changers. Two of those are better living, motel and sanitation, which fall under the PSG4. Yesterday, Minister Donald Grant and myself briefed the media on the progress made and future plans about better living model. She further announced 6 catalytic projects planned to deliver more than 100,000 houses by 2022. These projects were recently approved at the MinMec meeting, and planning processes are already underway, Mr. Deputy Speaker. They cover areas initially earmarked for N2 Phase 2, like your Barcelona, Europe, Kaka, Vukuzenzele, Kanana, Lusaka, Kosovo, and we also included Tsunami and Tabumpig as part of South Corridor development. Other areas outside the city of Cape Town include George, Thembalethu, Sefefontein, East and West, Wilderness, Transects in Brederfeli, Flakeland in Drakenstein. This is about 10 billion rand investment in the public infrastructure, Mr. Deputy Speaker. These projects will be funded mainly by public funds from taxpayers, not handouts or favor from the national government. Allocation to provinces are done in terms of the Act, Mr. Deputy Speaker, Division of Revenue Act. I'm mentioning this because I'm reminding people like Minister of Water and Sanitation, Nomvula Nonkumokonyane, who seem to think that by spending money in the Western Cape, she's doing us a favor. It is not her money or ANC's money, it's taxpayers' money. So now again, a clear indication, because one of the things that the members from this side spoke about is the transformation. And if you look at the transformation across the departments, one of those indicators are jobs that we spoke about, the services that we deliver that I spoke about. But let me also mention one of the very important things. Because one of the legacies that we must leave as this government is to make sure that we do not only employ people, but we empower those SMMEs. In this department, now in this department, for example, now I'm talking about something more than that actually now. Now let me talk about the empowerment of SMMEs. When I took over in this department, for example, only 22% in terms of value went to SMMEs, previously disadvantaged people. As I'm talking to you now in this department, 46% of the entire budget of this department goes to SMMEs, previously disadvantaged individuals. So we have moved beyond jobs, but we're talking about changing the structure of the economy by empowering previously disadvantaged people, mostly black, so that they become part Order of Minister, the economy. Your time is that is the expired. Real transformation, madam.
Thank you. Order the Honourable Christians.
Speaker, the Western Cape has set the bar very high when it comes to clean governance and service delivery. This government must gauge itself against international standards because it cannot gauge itself against its peers locally. The speech of Premier Zille addressed crucial areas, namely business confidence, energy crisis, innovation, investment as a precursor to job creation, e-learning and broadband, skills development and youth placement, and the ACDP welcomes the State of the Province address. Speaker, I would like to appreciate it if the Premier can tell us the 534 million, how the young people in the townships that are down and out, how are they going to benefit? In the Mannenbergs, in their Nova Parks, in the Langas, how are they going to benefit? Because they've been marginalized from the economic structures. These young men and women that do not have hope. Premier also mentioned about the alcohol abuse. It's a killer, the alcohol abuse is a killer and destroy our communities. The Premier spoke about reduction, and yet we have sub-councils that extended the liquor trading hours and also including Sundays. Premier can just elaborate on that. And then we come to the Conradie Hospital. And thank you very much that that deal of that 80 million with the previous MEC, Marius Franza, fell through the mat. Because he gave it to one of his cronies and it fell through the mat. So now 3,000 households can benefit from the Conradie Hospital project. Deputy Speaker, it's also important to understand that the Bible says, "Wat Jesaja gaan jy my," he brought impeachment and now is nowhere to be found. I hope that the ANZ least complicated with him his status, because he does not know. He says he hears everything via the media. So I just hope we will be informed about his status. Speaker, the after-school program is an excellent, and the extension on that program is an excellent idea, and we need that in our communities where parents are working and the children are not being looked after school. But can we ask the new leader of the opposition to get SACTU involved? Or does he only have influence over the three members in his own caucus, because he doesn't have the support of the entire caucus? So I wonder, will the leader be so bold enough to ask SACTU to help with this program, because it's much needed? Deputy Speaker, the other important thing mentioned by the Premier is the energy crisis that we have. And there was great initiatives by the Premier, innovative statements that she made. But we want to know, Premier, will the National Department buy into this? Because we know that Eskom has a monopoly. And although they fail, their bosses get bonus after bonus after bonus. So how is the Premier going to convince national government, for the best interest of this province, we need other ways of energy? The other area of that I just want to touch on, Deputy Speaker, is the youth cafes. That is working brilliantly. We visited them, youngsters can go to them. I would like to know, are we going to have more rollouts when it comes to youth cafes? We visited, it's full, there's excitement. Youth that do not have access, it's happening. I wonder, Deputy Speaker, if these members...
Order, Honourable Member, at the back there, please come to order.
I wonder if these members even visit those...
Order, just 1 second. Order, Honourable Dagmo.
Sorry, Deputy Speaker, could I draw your attention, this is an order point, in regard to the order paper for this speaker's list.
It says here
that speaker number 5, F. Christians, is from the ACDP, but I'm just wondering, should it not be DA?
Honourable Dagmo, order.
Come on.
Honourable Dagmo, order. Order. Honourable Dagmo, that is a frivolous point of order, you know that. Please continue.
Speaker, I must respond to that. He must be lucky.
You're taking your own time for that.
But yeah, he must be lucky if he's got a job tomorrow, because the new leader of the opposition is going to change some seats here. He's going to get rid. You see, Deputy Speaker, when Member Dagmore was MEC, he made a big balls up. So he's going to pay the price, and he's one. He doesn't know, because I know what's happening in the caucus. They're getting rid of them. So be careful. Oh, be careful. Be careful.
Please continue.
Deputy Speaker, the other thing that's very important is broadband, and we know, as COPA, we called in the department, and the Premier said broadband is important, e-learning is important, And I would like to know, by the Premier said by the end of 2016 it will be at old schools and people will have access to that. Do we have programs that will have youngsters coming after school, and how will those programs be conducted? Because we know in the poor of the poor areas, they don't have computers, they need these things, and that is a real tool to help our youngsters to be on track with where they are. I was shocked the other day, Speaker, when we visited the school, and young people in matric do not know what they want to become. So these tools that they're going to have and receive is very important if we want to have these people part of the economy of the Western Cape. Speaker, in closing, I want to say that I know that the speeches today will come and criticize the Premier, but I've challenged the ANC today to make contributions that will help the province going forward, and not to criticize because of the sake of criticizing, but really help this province going forward. I've made a few suggestions and they don't like it, but Premier, I would like you to respond. Thank you very much.
Thank you. The Achbare McKenzie.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Deputy Speaker, I'm delighted to be part of this debate today, and I'm mindful of the challenges that we're currently facing. 2016 is indeed going to be one of the toughest years ahead, and these sentiments were shared by the Honourable Premier last week in a speech and also in the newsletters inside government. And I certainly hope that the members of that side of the House would have paid attention to a speech last week, then they would have been able to respond effectively. The Honourable State of the Province respond by the Honourable Leader Magaka was clearly an archived version of one of Maria's old speeches. Or I'm not sure if it's Honourable Marius or he's still a member of this House, by the way. In fact, the member Cameron Dagmar was raising the issue of membership of the ACDP, but the Honourable Member Magaka made a clear backdoor entry into Parliament because this SACP never ran in elections. We can all remember that the President Zuma... it's the relevance to the debate because the Honourable Member is the Honourable Leader of the Opposition.
Order.
We all know the current situation. The economy lost 169 billion on 9/12.
Order, Honourable McKenzie. Order, just 1 second. Order, order. Please come to order before I allow the Honourable Member to continue. We can't have this continuous interjections and comments coming from the one side only. Please continue, Honourable Member.
Like I said, we all know that the economy lost 170 billion due to one disastrous decision by the Honourable President. In fact, the Premier is operating in that space at the moment because we have to cut budgets in the Western Cape because of the decision that President Jacob Zuma made. And if the Honourable Members see the ANC is having a march today, in fact, they're marching to the wrong house. Please turn the members around and march them to Parliament and impeach President Zuma. You successfully impeached Marius Fransson. Please go do the same to President Zuma. Madam Speaker, the Western Cape government continues to be a shining beacon of hope for this country. As the President continues to mess about, we govern. In fact, as the members alluded to in today's newspaper, Mr. Zuma said that Van Rooyen is the best man for the job. Then why did he let him go? In fact, Minister Manuel said he served 5 years as finance minister and has never heard of Minister Van Rooyen. So that's unfortunate. The provincial government in the Western Cape continues to find innovative ways to deal with red tape for small businesses and to ensure critical support. If the member, Honourable Magaka, read the Premier's speech or listened properly, the money that the Premier was allocating was to all youth in the Western Cape. His own members went to the youth cafe and applaud the hard work they're doing. The Honourable Member also raised the issue of the Premier that made about the libraries. What the Premier was highlighting was how successful that library is. And all of us, including the ANC members, went to the Khayelitsha Library on an oversight mission, and they were very overexcited by the hard work the Provincial Minister of Arts and Culture is doing there. In fact, we went a couple of weeks ago, we went to the Heritage Western Cape as well, and the ANC members as well. They were saying, yo, because it was so great, because that's what the Western Cape government do. We deliver where we govern. This finishes that. With regards to cultural affairs, I'd like to mention, as already alluded to in the Premier's State of the...
Order.
Deputy Speaker, can
order,
you protect me? Order. I can't hear myself.
Order. Now, I'm also battling in front here. May I again appeal to members on both sides of the House to calm down while the member speaks? The chair is battling to hear the Honourable Member properly. Speak to the chair, please, Honourable McKenzie.
In so far, the Premier alluded to the good work that we've done to advance social cohesion. That, Honourable Janki, is what you're looking for. And Mr. McLarker, what I'm going to do, if you just take down this number, it's 021-400-1300. This is the City of Cape Town's anti-racism line, which certainly you don't know, it's quite sad. And this was launched more than a year ago by the City of Cape Town already. So that's what you need to do, members. Take down the number, dial it, then you'll get what the City of Cape Town's anti-racism policy is. We look forward to the launch of the new Cape Town Museum as alluded, and that will be opened during Heritage Month is coming. The province has a rich history, and this museum will be sure to enlighten many of our people about our people's history, similar to the history of District 6. And sadly, not one of the ANC members attended the event last year on social inclusion. The event was organized by Minister Natim Tete, Minister of Arts and Culture. I was the only member of parliament that was there. Your national MPs were there, but not one of your caucus members were there. So they didn't take racism seriously. They should have attended that meeting, that whole day workshop. It was held in the gardens. None of them attended. They all were invited. Shame on you. Madam Speaker, the Premier further mentioned that the language unit had developed and launched the official isiXhosa terminology for chess and cricket. Through helping the language and standardizing words, we can truly promote the use of this beautiful language of all South Africans. That is social cohesion, work in action, a government in action, not merely talking about it, but actually doing. Madam Speaker, sport continues to provide opportunities for youth from all walks of life. And the Mort Centers as a growing chawa is such a success that it is. And I'd like to welcome here today Mr. Ibrahim Murat, who's sitting with us today, from the former teacher of the Good Hope School. He took the school from under 30 rugby players 3-4 years ago, currently 180 rugby players from Khayelitsha, Mitchells Plain. And that's what effective government is. So well done to you, Mr. Murat. And we're going to continue to try working with you in ensuring that more kids from Khayelitsha and Mitchells Plain get into the more centers and into our youth cafes. Speaker, important to the government of the Western Cape is creating safe opportunities for our young ones, including our youth. And what the Premier announced last year with an additional allocation of 26 million, all-encompassing 120 million for the youth opportunities. And that member, ACDP, Honourable Christian, that's hopefully answers your question. That's where the money to, because that money is going into our townships, into Khayelitsha, into Langa, and it's already gone into there as well. With the Premier, yes. Speaker, to further invest in skills development, that support for our youth, it's in the work placement opportunities, including the Premier's Advancement of Youth program, including the gap year of which the members have in committee, have received the information on those committee. Speaker, the Deputy Speaker, the Premier announced the game changes as the key priorities areas for this meeting. And all the members, hopefully all the members will pitch up on the Magaka, Honourable Frans van Hartley came to our meeting, I certainly hope you will come to our committee meetings, where the Premier will come and present the plans with the MEC. So how they're going to go about youth creation, all seven game changers will be in those committees, and I'm happy Member Dagbar has confirmed his attendance already, and I certainly hope that you will attend that meeting, because in the committees, which is the work of government, that's where the heart is, something Member Frans van never understood, that's why he never came to the meeting. Madam Speaker, in conclusion, I would like to welcome the support. I've highlighted some of the challenges, Mr. Dagmore, caused by your president, Mr. Jacob Zuma. Madam Speaker, I would like to welcome the State of the Province address, and on behalf of the DA, we fully support this address. Thank you.
Order. Order. Can we have full order, please, before we allow the Honourable Member Beerwinkel to start the speech? Honourable Beerwinkel.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. I actually need to address these confused members on the other side of the House who don't really know where they are, because most of their address has been about the SONA and not the Premier's address. So let us then do that. Deputy Speaker.
Order, order. I want to protect the on-member, please. Order. Member may continue.
Deputy Speaker, black lives have always mattered, not always their votes. In the SOPA of the Premier, she painted a utopia that only exists in her head, in the affluent areas and in desktop reports. The reality is very different, Speaker. And it's that sort of double speak that is the undoing of the DA's image of a non-racial caring party that is exposed again in your SOPA. The expectation of what you want allowed at National Assembly is exactly the rulings that count against us here in the legislature from members of the same party. The curtailing or reprimand of those who speak out against your internal racist practices or expose your racist members, as was emphasized in the weekend papers. It's a similar kind of double speak that we will address today from the SOPA. Another reality, Deputy Speaker, is that the DA government in this province forgets that their plans will come to naught without the allocation of taxpayers' money from National Treasury. Your very existence is dependent on National Government's allocation. Speaker, comments like useless and worse and hopeless were heard here as the Premier delivered her address the other day. But in the very next breath, she boasts about awards won and accolades given by that very National Government that they were just lambasting. They need to make up their minds. Do they want them or not? A capable government, a capable state has been bandished around here, Deputy Speaker, admits that it cannot do it alone. Your very existence, I repeat, is dependent on the goodwill of National. Black lives have always mattered. And that is why we as the ANC will continue to speak out against the stark differences of quality of life of the citizens of the Western Cape, especially in the rural areas, which you said nothing about. How important is education in its totality to the DA government if the Premier finds it necessary to mention, and my leader has very eloquently raised this issue, but I want to spin it from a different angle, that learners in Khayelitsha flock to a library. That's an indictment on your government for not providing all the necessary for a culture of learning with all the necessary assistance. And what you have deprived those learners of, flocking to a library. Why didn't you talk about learners that flock to a library in Sipunta Constantia? They don't have to because they've got it in their homes. Schools are becoming ganglands. Schools are becoming gangland territories, yet the SOPA contained nothing about how this DA government intends to rid institutions of learning of this evil. Speaker, farm workers in this province remain the poorest and most abused group of people. Almost every day the media screams headlines of evictions, physical abuse, verbal abuse, poor living conditions, autocratic decisions regarding people's rights, all in the face of ESTA legislation.
And order.
Are examples.
Order, member, just 1 second. May I again appeal to people on the gallery to refrain from commenting on the debate? The Speaker has ruled about that in the beginning, and I want to again ask you not to participate in the debate. Member, you may continue.
Thank you, members of the Grabouw community. We welcome you here, but please adhere to the rule. We will defend you. We will fight for you. The majority of these people have not yet tasted or experienced their freedom. ESTA legislation is in place, Deputy Speaker, disregarded by these farmers. Education, Speaker, is equally important to a farm school learner. But have you ever seen a farmer sacrifice his personal transport to get a young learner to school who lives outside of the 5-kilometer range? Have you ever seen a white child walking to school for those differences? How then, Premier, or the MEC of Education, do you not see the racism in that practice? Instead, MEC Schaefer schemes of how to close down farm schools and breaking up the hegemony of a community in the process. Those are our leaders of tomorrow. E-learning, this great innovation, we still need to understand how those very rural learners who need it the most will be benefiting by this initiative. This is an election year, Deputy Speaker, but those very farm workers who are treated as badly as they are will be driven to the venues and be intimidated to vote DA. But we will never stop speaking out about these racist injustices, because black lives, and not only their votes, have always mattered to us. The Premier continues to praise a fish for swimming. So, when a fire chief spends inordinate hours at work during a period of huge fire devastation, that's par for the course. Speak rather about the poor who lost their lives and possessions in these devastating fires and are no better off than they were then. Black lives also matter when disaster strikes, not only those who succumb during executions of their duties, and our hearts go out to their families also who were left behind. A manager at Cape Nature in the Cedarburg Nature Reserve also lost his life in a tragic accident, but no mention of him. His life mattered too. Speaker, then, when a department gets a clean audit, those are instructions from the Auditor General. But even the Auditor General admits that a clean audit is no proof of an outcome of service delivery. It is no proof of an outcome of service delivery. Deputy Speaker, is the Chief Whip speaking about himself? Because I know what an audit opinion means.
It does look like
order.
Overcrowding in informal areas such as Masipumulene, Imizamuyetu, and all the areas that were mentioned by my leader are stark realities of poor service delivery. But the Premier decided to duck that issue of sanitation and service delivery and pass it on to the City of Cape Town. The City of Cape Town is your municipality over which you have oversight. See to it that they do what they're supposed to do for the poor who are generally black. Premier said, most cases landing up in hospitals are from preventable diseases. She might be right, but preventable by whom? None other than you, the very Western Cape government, who think that it's okay for black families to live in shacks with no proper sanitation, no heating, no privacy, porta potties and bucket systems still exist, 4 to 5 families still share toilets and taps. How can these conditions not affect the quality of life of people who live there? Speaker, crime is at an all-time high. Employment opportunities are few. Youth are disillusioned. Drug abuse grows worse. Yet gambling...
Order. Please continue.
Drug abuse grows worse by the day. Yet gambling opportunities are being extended where the poor live by the extension of alcohol.
Order, member, just 1 second. Honourable Makasela.
Honourable Deputy Speaker, I would like to ask for your ruling on this. The Honourable Member Gillian says to Honourable Matigizela that you are a puppet, you are not an honourable. Now, I'm sure Deputy Speaker...
Order.
Deputy Speaker, I'm rising on a point of order and I will await your ruling, not their ruling.
Order. All members are regarded as honourable members. I did not hear saying he's not honourable, but the word puppet in isolation or in that respect is not unparliamentary, so I will allow the member to continue.
Where was I? Speaker, the DA continuously blames SAPS. Sorry. continuously blames SAPs in one breath, and in the next breath boasts about how innovative they are to deal with the problems together. And while we were being addressed here, shots rang out in Manenberg and some innocent persons became statistics. During that debate, the Premier looks up at the gallery to welcome the new Provincial Police Commissioner. Very strange. Why up there? Why was the new Provincial Commissioner not allowed to sit in the box where honoured guests sit? Speaker, the stark difference, we know that. The stark difference between services rendered, opportunities afforded.
Remember, your time unfortunately has expired.
With all of their interruptions, Deputy Speaker.
Unfortunately, it has expired some seconds ago already. I must see the Honourable Minister of Education next. Honourable Schaefer.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. On Friday, the Premier outlined three crucial requirements for a democracy to succeed: accountability, the rule of law, and a capable state. Essentially, she showed what it is like to live under a DA government, where these three requirements are present. In the Western Cape, we are showing that where the DA governs, life improves for everybody. Our economy is growing, unemployment is decreasing, money is used for the purpose for which it is intended, i.e. delivering services to all, and the poor in particular. And of course, our education system is flourishing. The fruits of this capable state are that since the DA came to power in the Western Cape in 2009, we have improved our matric pass rate from 75.6% to 84.7%. In the 2015 NSC, each one of quintiles 1, 2, and 3 achieved a pass rate of over 70%. Those are the poorest schools. They have improved by 16.5%, 15.8%, and 16.6% respectively since the DA came into government. Since 2009, the bachelor's pass rate in each of the poorest quintiles 1, 2, and 3 has increased by 15.9%. 10.9% and 12.5% respectively. There is still work to be done, but it is a work in progress and it is progressing very nicely. Under a DA government, we keep making progress. And under a DA government, the poor get better services. Our teachers are in the overwhelming majority in their classrooms teaching every day. They are committed to improving education for the children they teach. Even teachers from other provinces are so desperate to work in a capable state that I've had calls in my office from teachers asking if we have jobs for them. This is life under a DA government and a capable state. Unfortunately, we do not have jobs for them. The fact that we do not yet govern nationally means that we have not had the power to stop the institutional corruption and blatant mismanagement of government finances. And because of that, we are coming under increasing pressure as a provincial government, even though we manage our finances impeccably. The ANC has simply refused to deal with a corruption that is losing us billions of rands every year that we could use for better service delivery, especially more teachers. Several years ago, when Willy Hofmeyr was still the head of the then highly efficient SIU, he told us that in his estimation, corruption was costing this country 30 billion rand a year. Do you have any idea what we could do with that money? 30 billion rand could buy us 88,235 teachers, 545 new schools, or 300 million textbooks. And that is every single year, the minimum amount that is being lost to corruption. Recent reports indicate that since the ANC has been in power...
Order, Minister. Honourable Janchi, he can't comment on each statement made by the Minister, please.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Please, Minister, continue.
Recent reports indicate that since the ANC has been in power, 700 billion rand could have been lost to corruption. That is my entire budget for 38 years. Of course, Advocate Hofmeyr was removed from that position soon after he made that comment, so the ANC could continue with their program of a loot a continuer. Quite frankly, it is a national disgrace. Thanks to the ANC's desperation to cling to power and simple refusal to take decisions in the best interest of our country, we are now all suffering, and the poor worst of all. The Premier mentioned on Friday the crippling wage increases that have been agreed to by national government in an effort to keep the unions on board in the tripartite alliance. Because of this, we are sitting in a situation where we are going to have overcrowded classrooms, insufficient teachers, and insufficient money to expand our services to the poor. It is national's fault, so I will. We are doing our utmost to try and keep those services as they are at present, but there are severe pressures, and it is not by any means solely because of the global economic crisis. It is largely influenced by the ANC's total disregard of market forces, flip-flopping on crucial policy because they cannot agree amongst themselves, and the policy of cadre deployment, where they have put too many people in too many positions simply because of their loyalty to the ANC and the alliance, with the ability to do the job factoring into the equation very little, if at all. Excuses for the incapable state are getting more and more absurd by the day. Planet Zuma now has another inhabitant, Gwedi Mantashe. His comments last week really reflect the desperation of an organization that simply does not know what to do. Because in order to do the right thing, they have to make decisions that will upset one or other faction or alliance partner. Which brings me on to accountability. In the National Assembly last week, the poor performance of Langa High School was referred to. Yes, well, if they did that in the NA, I would have. Now, notwithstanding the fact that even our poorest quintile schools achieved an average of more than the entire Northern Cape, Limpopo, KwaZulu-Natal, and Eastern Cape provinces, this particular school has been identified as one of our new collaboration schools. We have private funders and operators who wish to help fund and develop schools in poor communities. And guess who is opposing it? None other than the ANC's trusty alliance partner, SATU. The very organization that opposes any measure to try and improve education and accountability, including systemic tests and annas. So don't go running off to the National Assembly trying to make it look as if we don't care about poor communities. It is the ANC and its allies that do not care about poor communities. We are trying something new. They are trying to stop it. In addition, last week, SATU aligned teachers at Oranje Kloof Primary, another collaboration school, where the parents have voted overwhelmingly in favor of this project, marched to the city to protest at the WCED against this model. Did they do it after school? Oh no, they left at 10 a.m. and closed the school. That shows you how much the ANC's allies care about education. As they say, birds of a feather flock together. And on the subject of birds, there was a lot of chirping last week from the other side of the house about school safety. So let's say something about that. Obviously, a lot fewer than under your MEC tenure. Obviously, the safety of our learners is of paramount importance to us and is something to which we give ongoing attention. However, we all know that, and I quote, "The challenge facing our schools cannot be dealt with in education alone and requires an integrated response guided by partnerships at local and provincial level." That was a quote from a speech at the Safe Schools Summit on the 24th of August 2005 by then MEC Cameron Doug Moore. Of course, because they weren't as effective. Of course, the partnerships also extend to the national sphere of government, which controls the SAPs. Furthermore, to show the ANC's hypocrisy, even when it comes to this crucial aspect, at the end of last year, Minister Motshekga arranged a school safety summit because of the concerns expressed across the board and across the country about safety in schools. Guess who attended it? One MEC from the entire country. One MEC attended the safety summit, and that was me. That's true. As they say, actions speak louder than words, and the ANC's actions speak volumes. Now the president's also announcing that central procurement will become compulsory. Well, perhaps he has not heard of concurrent competences and independent spheres of government, but we will not sit back and watch the centralized Guptarization of procurement. We will not allow the gains we have made to descend into the cesspit of ANC corruption and mismanagement and lose control over our ability to deliver, which, as we have shown again and again, is infinitely more efficient than national government. It is clear that the DA government in the Western Cape is the epitome of the capable state and accountable, fair government. Under the DA, people have more opportunities and especially a better education, which is the foundation on which all other opportunities are built and is the key to achieving genuine freedom. Just to deal with a few issues of the Honourable Bierwinkel. Honourable Bierwinkel seems to have forgotten that we owe our existence to the Constitution of South Africa, not to the national government. And the national government itself also, in fact, owes their existence to the national constitution. We agree that people in wealthy areas don't need libraries. That's why we're providing libraries in poor communities, because they need them. That's precisely the point. And as far as closing schools is concerned, your beloved national government has the policy of closing schools and rationalizing schools across the country. Eastern Cape is closing about 1,000, and we engage them all the time. So you really are scraping the barrel today with the ANC in this debate. Sorry, thank you very much.
Order. The Honourable Bernard Joseph.
Thank you, Speaker. Let's look at the statement made by the Office of the Western Cape Premier on the 19th of February, 2016. What a joke. open quote. Yet in our midst, there are hundreds of thousands of young people marginalized from the modern economy and disproportionately damaged by broken families, alcohol, drugs, and violence. The positive vibrancy of Cape Town is not the experience, close quote. Open quote. Origins of political order and political decay, close quote. The latter part clearly describes the DA and the problems above pertaining to alcohol and drugs. The DA is a crime-friendly party. Our people, the poorest of the poor, are further marginalized by this failed DA system, a system that caters only for the rich in Kemps Bay, Greenpoint, Bishop's Courts, and many other affluent areas. However, nothing is done in Nyanga in terms of the implementation of projects that is the murder capital of South Africa and the province to prevent crime. Good governance afoot. The Premier boasts about the Education Department getting a clean audit, a school in Wallacedean with two functional toilets for 1,700 learners. School benches are falling apart and ripping children's clothes in Belhar and Delft. Education funding to poorer schools are lacking. The unequal funding of schools must be properly investigated and adjusted. Crowded classrooms is another problem, more especially in Khayelitsha. In Khayelitsha, there's a school matriculants at this stage doesn't even have educators for certain subjects. How do you expect the matric rate to increase at the end of the year? Good governance, sir.
Order.
Let's talk about the unemployment. EPWP is like labor broking. Cheap temporary labor by the failed DA system. Give people their dignity back by providing our people with meaningful and permanent employment. Don't worry, I will come to you in terms of moral ethics. It's not easy to agree with you on many occasions, but I have to agree with your statement that our unemployment rate is still much too high. Hence, the DA employed an official of the Department of Health who was dismissed for fraudulent appointments, now being reappointed in the Helderberg District Office of Health. Good governance, sir, food. The very high cost of employment should be reduced, especially...
Mr. Joseph, just one second. Minister Marikizela.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, the honourable member must withdraw the word sir, food. It's unparliamentary.
Order. No, I'm quite happy with that. It's a way of saying it in Afrikaans. I've got no problem. You may continue.
The very high cost of employment should be reduced, especially those employment opportunities created for DA party supporters. Cater deployment, just like the ANC. Good governance of food. 534 million. Set aside for TVET colleges, yet another failed attempt to train the poor, whereby many students end up working at ShopRite and Spar. Then another 120 million being set aside for work placement. Isn't this precisely what the province so highly described as political decay? Good governance of food. Open quote. Demand for affordable housing closer to the city bill is an important priority for a functional city. And this can be achieved more effectively if the state complements the market mechanisms appropriately. We have to create a much more inclusive city at a time of resource scarcity. This requires innovation. Close quote. Blikkiesdorp and Wolverivier are just a few of the prime innovations of better living by the DA. Yeah. success of the city of Cape Town and towns in the rural areas are embarking on by evicting people from houses, but yet have given away land cheaply to the rich people in Stellenbosch, clearly illustrate the way minority white farmers are getting preferential treatment in this province under the DA administration compared to the poor people in the rest of the province. Farm evictions occurs daily and leaves the poor farm workers with insurmountable problems to find alternative accommodation. Some farmers have 10 to 15 pieces of very expensive agricultural land and which are being rented at less than 10,000. Legislation indicates if a farm is being leased for more than 10 years, it must be registered with the deed offices. In none of these situations, these farms were registered with the deeds office. Just yesterday, we, in terms of good governance, we have seen a situation where a landlord has received a bill of 103,000 for the month of February from the city of Cape Town. Good governance, Sir Foot. Failure to release land audit reports. The economic freedom fighters will continue to grab land because the DA government hasn't delivered on its promises.
Order, member, your time has now really expired. I've given you some injuries.
Just want to conclude.
Your last sentence.
Just want to conclude. Die vlakte in Stellenbosch, wat op die oomblik 'n verrassing is, is die betrokkenheid van Universiteit van Stellenbosch om beurse te gee aan afstammelinge van die vlakte gemeenskap. Die vraag is, waarom en hoeveel van die afstammelinge kry beurse van Universiteit van Stellenbosch? The 26 inside of the provincial
order
to highlight the plight of the poor in the Western Cape and were uninspired. Good governance of food.
Order. Honourable member, Akbar Lid Joseph. Die stoel buig agteroor om die kleiner partye te beskerm en meer tyd te gee, maar dan moet die tyd nie uitgebuit word nie. Ek het die ruimtyd gegee. As die stoel vir orde vra, dan beteken dit orde. I see the Honourable Minister Mbombo.
Honourable Speaker, Honourable Premier of the Western Cape, members of the Provincial Cabinet, Honourable members, community leaders in the gallery, members of the media, and most importantly, the people of the Western Cape, good morning. Honourable Speaker, allow me to thank the Honourable Premier on the Friday, reminding us that for government, building a capable state is the great morative imperative for creating a decent life for the people of this province. The South African economy is in decline. Those in business have been sounding the warning bells for some time. However, this decline also impacts the pockets of the poor and on our government's ability to deliver public services, especially healthcare. It is imperative for government to create an environment that improves the health of its population by investing in health services. Quoting United Nations Ban Ki-moon, who once said, investment in basic services can bring a sixfold increase in economic return. Healthy populations have higher life expectancy, go to school, are more productive, have lower birth rates, and thus invest more in fewer children. Our country has invested in legislative framework, policies, strategies, charters, plans, protocols, guidelines, and reforms. Despite these interventions, nationally, the health outcomes remain low, and the poor quality of services is the norm rather than the exception. Internationally, the country is rated as one of the worst health systems, especially for a country that is more economically viable compared to other African countries that have experienced civil wars. Now, the question is why? Honourable Speaker, let's not mince the words. We have seen in the provincial governments that are governed by the ANC where actually they don't care about giving these services to the poor. Just a hospital, for example, that was the only hospital that has been there in the Cape Flats. They've never built any hospital. And the Just a Hospital was an old age home, and where it was found that there was a problem with the occupational hazards. Khayelitsha Hospital in 2012, Mitchell's Plain Hospital in 2013. These are the hospitals that were built during the time that the DA was in government.
Order, Minister, just 1 second. I sense the Honourable Member Wiley wants to address me on the interjections from Honourable Dugmore and Dianchi.
That's the one.
Please, I agree with you, Honourable Honourable Dugmore and Dianchi. Allow the member to continue.
Look at the failure of the ANC government in building a capable health state. Number one is the appointment of a competent workforce. The human resource for health strategy of 2011 is gathering dust and we're still waiting. The Health Leadership and Management Academy that was formed in 2012 was nothing more than an attempt to reverse the damage caused by the appointment of incompetent cadres in the senior management in the health sector, and nothing still is being said about it. Look at the example of the Eastern Cape provinces, where they had four acting HODs in 1 year. KwaZulu-Natal, on the other hand, appointed a CFO who was suspected of financial mismanagement from the other province. Madam Speaker, this is like appointing a fox to look after your chickens. By the end of the previous year, it was estimated that there were some 14,000 vacancies for doctors at state hospitals across the country, and this is not a new problem. According to the Institute of Race Relations, in the early 2013, Limpopo had the highest public sector doctor vacancy rate in the country at 86%. The Northern Cape was recorded at 57%, while the Eastern Cape was set at 48%. The vacancy rate for nurses was no better. Look at Limpopo once again, had the highest nurse vacancy rate at 68%, followed by the Eastern Cape at 67% and the Free State at 47%. Whilst the slashing of provincial budgets and still no tangible plan from the national government for effectively filling the vacancies, existing problems are sure to worsen across the country. We've already seen the government's inability to absorb the new crop of health professionals into the system. Tatu Speaker, if we're prioritizing redress and service delivery, then we cannot have young, especially the black medical and nursing professionals sitting at home nursing their degrees. Any person with an understanding of our past, its footprint, and our present, and the current state of the economy will understand this. In the Western Cape, for example, the population grows at 2.6%. You are sure to see a rise in the number of people requiring access to public health care, irrespective of a shrinking public purse. The question we are faced is how does government, in pursuit of creating a capable state, respond to these kind of conditions? Near the end of last year, the AG found that the wasteful expenditure, for example, in Gauteng, had amassed to 160 million rands. Not wanting to be outdone, same applies even with their transport department, for example. In the Eastern Cape, my favorite province, one of our least developed provinces, the health department lost 74 million to wasteful expenditure. The Northwest Department of Health, amongst other departments in that province, found itself under administration and also accrued 263 million in irregular expenditure. So what does effective and capable government look like? It is clean, it is innovative, it is responsive, and governs with integrity. In the Western Cape, we have maintained 11-year track records of sound financial management as evidenced by unqualified audits. Honorable Speaker, Deputy Speaker, on the score of service delivery, we have already achieved, for example, the antiretrovirals, which has increased our clients from 75,000 in 2009 to 181,000 in the year 2014-15. If you look at terms of the prevention of the mother-to-child HIV transmission, we have brought it down from 3.6 in 2009 to 1.4% in 2014. And if you compare with Gauteng, it's only managed 2.7%. Our maternal mortality ratio is 78 compared to the national norm of 146 per 100,000. The KZN ratio is 160, Mpumalanga 173, and the worst performer is Limpopo with 185. In this province, it means that being poor and pregnant is a death sentence. It's like opening your own coffin, akuyilubuyayo, when you are pregnant. We have increased the TB cure rate from 79% in 2009 to 80% last year. And if you compare again with other provinces, Eastern Cape battles with a 70.5%, Limpopo is 64%. Honorable Deputy Speaker, finally, the responsiveness in innovation at the heart of the Western Cape government. And if you look in terms of the white paper, the National Health Insurance, I cannot miss that, It borrows on best practices that already is the model for hospital management in the Western Cape. And if you look in terms of how they've appointed their GPs in other provinces, it looks as if now they'll be adopting the Western Cape methodology on how to fix the mess that they've already implemented. We have already decentralized decision makings on budget to the managers of healthcare institutions by empowering healthcare professionals to make decisions about the priorities of their facility. The allocation of budgets and the appointment of staff can be tailored to the unique needs of facilities and communities. If you look at other provinces, for example, one has to wait for months before a window is fixed, years before the doctors are appointed, and ages before service providers are paid, resulting in medically compromising drug stockouts. Honorable Deputy Speaker, this government is the one that will find that it's quick on its feet, and also it knows how to run a capable state. And we've seen in the other governments where we'll find that the health of the poor is being affected. And then the question we ask now, who has got the heart of the poor? This government or the one that allows the people to die?
I see, Honorable Janchi. Honorable Janchi. Honorable Janchi. Order, the Honorable Minister Grant.
Deputy Speaker, Honorable Premier, Cabinet colleagues, Leader of the Opposition, Honorable members of the Western Cape Parliament, guests. I rise with pleasure to participate in this debate on the Premier's State of the Province address of last week. An address delivered in the context of a South Africa still reeling from the economic turmoil caused by a president who clearly has at best a tenuous grasp of, or at worst a total disregard for, the impact of irresponsible political announcements on international and market confidence in this country. As if this were not enough, the world has also had to endure the spectacle of a once respected parliament upon which all South Africans optimistically pinned their hopes of a better future, reduced at times to the level of a badly disciplined and mismanaged primary school classroom. The burden of restoring some of the shattered confidence now falls on the shoulders of Minister Gordon, who mercifully for South Africa ended up occupying the finance office once President Zuma had finished his game of musical chairs. Estimated at 500 billion rand in lost value, the most expensive parlor game in South African history. Speaker, I presume many members of this House read the highly respected weekly publication, The Economist, which has appeared continuously since 1843. In this week's edition, there's a short article on reforming FIFA, which begins as follows. Every so often, organizations become bywords for something else. Apple means elegance, Berkshire Hathaway loyalty, and BlackBerry decline. Alas, FIFA, the governing body of world football, spells corruption. Sprucing up this most tarnished of brands will take more than a bit of tinkering with the way FIFA is run. On the 26th of February, FIFA's member associations will hold a secret ballot. What else? In Zurich to choose a new president who will replace Sepp Blatter. The omens are not good. Mr. Blatter bequeathed his successor an organization in chaos. His fifth term was cut short after the indictment last year of several of the game's biggest wigs for alleged money laundering. Fellow members of this House, as serious as the association of corruption is with the name and affairs of FIFA, and as enormous are the amounts of money involved, FIFA remains a controlling body of what is at the end of the day a sport, something meant for recreation and a platform on which to display feats of athletic ability, skills, and teamwork. The beautiful game is still a game, not life itself. FIFA is certainly not a government charged with caring for its citizens, upholding and respecting a long-fought-for constitution, ensuring a functional social environment, and understanding and nurturing an economy which can deliver jobs to people so that they can feed their families with pride, and not be dependent on grants and handouts.
Order, please.
Which ensure their continued reliance on favours open to political manipulation. And so, Speaker,
order, please, members.
If Apple means elegance, Berkshire Hathaway means loyalty, BlackBerry means decline, and FIFA spells corruption, what has the ANC government in 2016 become a byword for? Is it the once admired struggle for freedom from the shackles of apartheid, or is it the relentless plundering of state resources through CADA redeployment? The abuse of the many opportunities
order.
Cynically created through state-owned enterprises and dubious tender allocations, and the grotesque enrichment of a few obedient loyalists at the expense of the hopes, dreams, and aspirations of millions. As we sit here today, I think we all know the answer,
Honourable
Speaker,
Minister,
to this rhetorical question.
Will you please take your seat for a minute? Honourable Dianke, you have a speaking turn directly after this. If you could just contain yourself until then, thank you. You'll get your chance. You may proceed, Honourable Minister.
And so, Speaker, for reasons entirely different from those of many ordinary people in South Africa, the ANC must be hoping that Minister Gordon is able to pull a field of rabbits out the hat tomorrow. Without this, the slippery slope looms large. It is against this background that the Honourable Premier delivered her address last week, stressing the need for continued service excellence during a time of austerity and a time of central fiscus cutbacks in the face of poor management of the economy and the impact of the drought. Over and above this ongoing need for quality service, the Premier highlighted a number of initiatives, game changers, aimed at making a demonstrable difference to the lives of many residents in the Western Cape and at ensuring that this province retains its reputation for working better together with the people who choose to live here. Speaker, the combination of capital flight from South Africa and the cutbacks poses particular challenges to my department as the lead agent in delivering infrastructure requirements, upon which so many of the services highlighted by the Premier depend. In one way or another, the Department of Transport and Public Works is also involved in most of the game changers. Apart from providing the enabling infrastructure itself, the department has a crucial role to play in that its maintenance and construction projects are key sources of job creation and economic empowerment. Every possible opportunity has to be grasped to maximize the economic benefit of this capital expenditure against a background in which, across the country since 1994, within both public and private sectors, the ratio of fixed capital investment to GDP has decreased significantly. Under these circumstances, it is crucial that government aligns and sequences its efforts so that the correct messages are sent to the private sector to establish partnerships with government to ensure that the deteriorating fixed capital to GDP investment ratio I've referred to is restored over time. The role which large public works programs played in the New Deal solution to an earlier recession in the United States must not be forgotten. In doing this, we have to focus infrastructure spending in such a way to maximize returns, and these returns including enabling our sister departments to deliver on their services and to minimize the negative economic externalities which have brought us to where we are today. A prime example is the road network in this province. Often the subject of positive comments by our increasing number of visitors to the Western Cape. Of the 32,000 kilometres of roads making up the Western Cape road network, 20% is surfaced, but this 20% carries 95% of all road traffic. In addition, the overwhelming majority of our road network has fared to very good visual condition index. Although much of our surface road network is over 25 years old, our planned and focused maintenance spend has protected our massive investment in ensuring that the economy of this province is able to keep moving. The current asset value of the road network is just over 72 billion if you include the gravel roads. The estimated replacement value is in excess of 90 billion. It would be simply irresponsible not to maintain an asset base of this magnitude and importance to our economy. As irresponsible speaker, as willy-nilly destroying investor confidence by playing musical chairs with key posts in the National Cabinet to satisfy some as yet unconfirmed political agenda. By contrast, the route map set out by the Premier of this province last week is clear, responsible, and achievable. The commitment of my department to play its part in the successful implementation in the interests of the residents of this province and the well-being of the country at large. I thank you.
Thank you, Minister. I see the Honourable Dianki.
Some love. For the Honourable Premier Zille and the DA, the end is beckoning. She has summed up the end by her so-called dedication to youth of her last 3 years. For the ANC, the beginning of the end for her and the DA starts in 6 months' time, now in 2016. Local government 2016 will provide the seeds of exit. 3 years is too far and too long.
Order, please, members.
Amasa de Golangi. The blow pope sal dance. I was hoping that the MEC for Health was going to talk about the polyclinic in Hold Bay, but she was certainly asked to talk about the Eastern Cape and other provinces because she might upset the apple cart in that constituency. When the sun sets, what will the Premier and the DA be remembered for? The Blue Brigade will proclaim all manner of glossy titles. I want to assert that many who voted for her party and many more who did not vote for the DA will nod and share the following amongst others. That Helen Zille, Honorable Helen Zille and the DA will be remembered for positioning the Western Cape government as opposition to key national imperatives and the national government. Each page of their contributions is punctuated by a contrast and comparison with national government. It's a DA template. You've listened to them, from Honorable Madikizela and all of them. She will be remembered for entrenching and deepening inequalities amongst the communities of this province. For under the DA, the situation has worsened. The allocation of resources remain and continues to be skewed. She will be remembered too for catchy concept and sound bites, with a disconnect with people's real life situation in Grabo, in Mitchell's Plain, in Mannenberg, in Nyanga and Danone. She will also be remembered for claiming credit out of success of a privileged province, which has been so since the dawn of democracy, as I will show later. Allow me to borrow, Honorable Speaker, from Premier Zille's inspiration. Concluding the 2015 SOPA, she said, and I quote, open quote, finally, strategy goal 5 seeks to embed good governance and integrated service delivery through partnerships and spatial alignment. None of our plans can be realized without a capable state and strong partnership with all stakeholders in our society. That then is the plan in broad outline. Drill deeper, and there will be an enormous amount of detail in the plans we are crafting to turn vision into action and outcome. Fast forward 2016, Premier, where is the detail in the plans? We could not get it on Friday. Something you promised 12 months ago. Of the many intentions you shared with us on Friday, it is your conclusion of SOPA 2015 and your emphasis of the capable state that I want to pay attention to. It is one submission that a capable state embodies the following features, amongst others: the promotion of active citizenry to ensure that they are the masters of their own destiny, the building of the capacity of the state itself and related institutions, the nurturing of genuine partnership through leadership in society. In your State of the Province address, you claimed that your government is committed to achieving a capable state. You further claimed that you are committed to creating opportunities for growth and jobs. In our view, embedding good governance, integrated service delivery, and achieving a capable state requires that the capacity of the state be prioritized. I put it to you, Premier, that your very own department cannot be regarded as a department in a government that pursues the noble goal of a capable state. The Department of the Premier is utilizing consultants on a daily basis, including giving those consultants state assets such as laptops, offices, and telephones. This is a Premier that says, I want a capable state. How is it possible to advocate for back office rationalization and austerity measures whereas you have a consultancy-based department? Skilled personnel at senior levels are regarded redundant and not fit for purpose according to them, yet they are highly paid. I go to the next one.
Honorable Danke, the just provincial manage treasurer, that finger, please.
The Provincial Treasury Department experience significant under-expenditure as a result of non-filling of vacancies. Talk about job creation. The entity of the department itself, the gambling board, spends millions of rands in courts and legal processes against its own staff and members. The local government department, the third one, continues to experience abnormally high turnover of staff. Municipalities and councillors across the province are on a weekly basis entangled in corrupt activities. The DA's story in local government reads like a horror story. Cape Town is under corruptive clouds of paying 5 billion more than the tender prices for the stadium, found by the High Court to have a corrupt tender given to the value of 130 million. The Hawks have recently brought to court official Paul Harting and two women who siphoned tenders of 70 million in a fraudulent way to their own businesses. And the scandalous of 30 million with the Cape Town soccer continues. This so-called good story of Cape Town, the DA's flagship project, is debunked by the many problems with councillors like Peter van Dalen shooting at small boys playing with a ball in Kailisha at night while the shooters laugh at the children who scream for life. Cheval Arense taking workers' money from subcontractors to pay themselves. Village After asking High Court for a lesser sentence of a convicted murderer. Sam Pinar is given a senior position despite him not disclosing the fact that he was part of the Trojan Horse plan that saw the random killing of three children. Chris Yordan was given a senior position despite being fired from the city for selling two cars for his own gain without permission. In the Eden
Order,
district,
please.
There's bias here at the end of In the Eden district, there are still unresolved issues with Mayor Bessie van der Westhuizen. That should have been removed on the accommodation of the DA caucus. And one Tasha Simmers that cannot stay out of trouble. In George municipality, Mayor Charles Thunder, who stands accused of domestic and gender violence. That's all in the DA. The list is long. I can go on. Nomonde Depo admitted to stealing council electricity. And yet they get to just a slap on the wrist. In the same way Diana Colabandard got it.
Where's Andy Levine, by the way? We still have
with the assistance of national government, we are now beginning to see stability and signs of recovery in Oudtshoorn. With fanfare, we are told of amazing work done by the Red Tape Reduction Initiative. We now have 700 new ideas and suggestions from employees of this province. This is supposed to be groundbreaking and a first. This initiative dates back to 2013. 3 years on, we are yet to be finished with real progress. What happened to the thousands of previous suggestions reported in the 2013-2014 annual report, Honorable Windy? We here have a government that spends money on suggestions, on consultants, and consents. Let me now deal with the misrepresentation of delivery starts by the DA hacks. The DA is now notorious for claiming historical reality of a privileged province and appropriate it as a DA creation and success. Let me bring the facts delivered by our own Deputy Minister Bodimana Mela in his response to the State of the Nation address, with the heading that the Western Cape has always been the place of milk and honey. In 1996, 85% of electricity and lighting was in the Western Cape. And in 2011, we have 93%.
What was the population there now?
I'm coming to that. In 1994, Limpopo had 39%. In 1994, and in 2011, Limpopo is on 87%. Here, the essence
here
is that between Limpopo and the Western Cape, who changes the lives of people better? It is Limpopo. It is Limpopo. Because even if you are to go back when the DA took over and assess the rate between what it inherited and what it did, I want you to go and do that homework. You did very little. In terms of access to pipe
order,
water.
Order, please, members. There's a speaker on the floor.
I'm mindful of my time. In terms of access to pipe water, in 1996, the Western Cape was on 89%. And in 2011, listen to this, in 2011, the Western Cape was on 88%. It regressed. It regressed. Free State, I'm contrasting now. Free State in 1996 was on 70%. Free State in 2011 is on 89%, above the Western Cape. Who's changing the lives of people better?
Order, please, members. Honorable Danke, please just take your seat. Honorable members. There will be an opportunity to respond. Please allow the speaker on the floor. You're drowning at the speaker and I cannot hear him. So can I please... Mensa, luister asseblief. Honorable Dianki, you may take the floor. Thank you. Minister Madikizela.
You can go back to your 2011 census and stats essay, exactly what you are reading. You are very selective.
Please manage your finger.
My apologies, Speaker. In fact, what we are witnessing, and this is the issue about the DA, in the DA, nothing else matters. The problems of a lack of service delivery, rising poverty, deepening inequality, joblessness, crime, homelessness are less important in the DA. Into a balekle with DA, you gold, you silver, ne bronze, wrong as a necomoro. Abana staraka, nongabi cock and cons or a Mitchell's Plain, a man in bag, a Kyalicha, a Elsus River. You know, my phone, you clean audit. That's the DA. Because for them, it is about ticking those boxes. What the DA is interested in is black votes. not their black lives.
Honourable Janki, Honourable Janki, your time has expired. Please take your seat. Thank you. Your time has expired. Thank you.
Dot scenes, Helen and Blow Popper.
Members, can we get a semblance of order, please? There's too much noise. I recognise the Honourable Wenger. You may proceed.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Premier Helen Zille spoke about the importance of the capable state. The capable state is the great moral imperative
order, please,
of our
ladies.
Time, because it is through a capable state that we can turn plans into reality. And a capable state also means a safe state. But policing is a national government competency. The state at a national level has been run exclusively by the ANC for the past two decades. It is clear that the ANC has been unable to address the historical unequal police service provision because the majority of crime victims are poor, black, and colored people. Indeed, those areas that are most affected by crime are areas where poor people live, and it is in these areas that the police have deployed the fewest resources. The ANC says that they are tackling racial and economic inequality, but in the one area that the ANC controls exclusively, which is policing, has seen a deliberate under-resourcing in poor areas which need it the most. It is clear that the lives and safety of the poor do not matter to the ANC. They come to this house and continually make the juxtaposition of Khayelitsha and Camps Bay and the so-called leafy suburbs. But in the case of policing, it's absolutely true. Nyanga has a police-to-population ratio of 1 to 878. Delft, 1 to 693. Mfuleni, 1 to 671. And Khayelitsha, 1 to 556. While Camps Bay has one of the best police-to-population ratios
order,
in the
please.
Province. When the DA takes the keys to the union buildings in 2019, we will create a South Africa in which children are safe and citizens are able to walk in our cities and townships without fear. Victims of crime will receive appropriate support and will be treated with compassion. We will start by increasing the number of operational SAPS members to 250,000. This would give us a ratio of one SAPS member to 202 citizens, a ratio that would put us above the international median, but is more appropriate for the level of crime experienced
order,
in
please,
South Africa.
Members,
we would
Wenger,
further boost
if you
these...
Could just please take your seat. Members, there's too much noise. We have a speaker on the floor and you're drowning the speaker out. I'm appealing to both sides of the House. Please allow the Honourable Member to present. You may proceed, Honourable Wenger.
Thank you, Speaker. We would further boost these numbers with a strong volunteer corps. The DA would provide the opportunity for South Africans to do volunteer service in the SAPS. Upon completion of the program, volunteers would have the option of being considered for permanent police service or to qualify for an opportunity voucher to further their studies or to start a small business. This is a far cry from the zero number of police reservists recruited in the Western Cape in the last 3 years. A DA national government would ensure that new SAPS members are appropriately trained. We would not sacrifice quality in an attempt to achieve higher quantities of police members. We will maintain high standards for recruitment and allocate sufficient funds for training. We will improve shift management systems to ensure minimum service level standards and ensure that adequate
order,
staff
please.
Accommodation is offered to police members in their initial years of service. These are just some of the tangible policy proposals we are putting forward to increase the safety of citizens of South Africa. By contrast, the only retort from the ANC is on Bambananis. Bambananis, however, were so poorly managed under the ANC that in 2007, their own MPL, Patrick McKenzie, expressed disappointment that they got funding under Leonard Ramatlakane. He said that Bambananis were no longer what they were intended to be and the concept needed to be revisited. A year later, communities said the project was a complete failure and should be revisited. So why now come and make as if Bambananis are the silver bullet that are going to solve our crime troubles? In fact, the ANC discredit all independent
order.
Research that doesn't fit their narrative. For example, the ANC keeps saying that Cape Town is the most unequal city in our country, yet the United Nations reveals that Cape Town is the most equal city in South Africa, and it's three ANC municipalities that are the most equal in our country. This is a case of Orwellian doublethink. The act of simultaneously accepting two contradictory beliefs as correct, to tell deliberate lies while genuinely believing them, and to forget any fact that has become inconvenient.
Honourable Wenger, please take your seat. Honourable Wiley, Chief of Wiley.
Yes, Speaker. Yes, it's a lekker klompe aan 'n kant daar, please.
Thank you. The honourable members, may I ask the honourable members, the back bench of the ANC, please? If you can tone it down, I can understand interjection, but you cannot drown out a speaker, please. You may proceed, Honourable Wenger.
This is a case of Orwellian doublethink, the act of simultaneously accepting two contradictory beliefs as correct, and to tell deliberate lies while genuinely believing them, and to forget any fact that is inconvenient. They question Stats SA on jobs because the facts are inconvenient. They discredit the Auditor General's reports, saying that clean audits mean nothing, because the facts are inconvenient. This is probably because ANC municipalities cannot come close to the same level of audit proficiency. Their provinces are not exactly a shining example of clean audits. As the Daily Maverick notes, the ANC bumbles their way through the business of governance, but that's because their business is not governance, it's the capture and exercise of power. For them, it is state capture, not the capable state. Where are the outcomes, they asked? The outcomes are in the fact that clean audits mean prudent and efficient use of taxpayers' money for the purpose they were intended, service delivery. And if that is meaningless, then that just goes to show the extent of rot within the ANC. Premier Helen Zille spoke about the importance of the capable state, that it is the great moral imperative of our time, because it is through the state, capable state, we can turn plans into reality. Clean audits are a barometer, a green light on the capable state, and that is why they are important. They mean money is not being spent on fire pools, on jets, and fruitless and wasteful expenditure. The ANC's Cyril Ramaphosa recognizes this. He said that South Africa is facing significant challenges in the area of governance, and that too many departments at provincial and national level continue to receive qualified audits, and that is why he said there's the need for a capable state. To quote award-winning singer-songwriter Alanis Morissette, isn't it ironic, don't you think? The Premier delivered an address to make citizens proud. Despite challenging economic times, the Western Cape is progressing on jobs. The Western Cape is progressing on the economy. The Western Cape is progressing in education and in infrastructure. This must be a bitter pill to swallow for the ANC. The only province where the ANC doesn't govern is the best performing province of them all. We, however, still have much work to do and will continue to make progress, because we have a great moral imperative to deliver a capable state for the inhabitants of our dear province. Thank you.
Order, please, members. Order, please. I see the Honourable Minister, Minister Bradal.
Honourable Speaker, Honourable Premier, President Nelson Mandela said 21 years ago, and I quote, "As long as the unfortunate conditions created by the old order remain, the people will remain restless. Their discomfort will give rise to waves of instability. The challenges before all of us is to create conditions which begin to transform their conditions of living and give them new hope of a better future." President Nelson Mandela went on to say, "Freedom should not be understood to mean leadership positions or even appointments to top positions. It must be understood as the transformation of the lives of ordinary people in the hostels and in the ghettos, in the squatter camps and on the farms and in the mine compounds." Honourable Speaker, 22 years into a democratic South Africa, we have had 22 years of ANC rule, 22 years of cadre deployment, 22 years of ANC corruption, 22 years under a national ANC government with no vision, 22 years of a national ANC government set to enrich themselves and neglect the poor. Shame on the ANC, Honourable Speaker. The honest question we must ask ourselves is the following. have the lives of ordinary people improved over the past 22 years under ANC government, and is the ANC government providing a capable state? The answer is no, Honourable Speaker. Honourable Speaker, vir die wat van my verskil, the Honourable, the Yankee, he still looks at the stats of 2011, not telling the people that this province has grown by 28.7%. But Honourable Speaker, while the Honourable the Yankees in 2011, we look at 2015. In the province he compare us with, in the province he compare the Western Cape with, in Limpopo, you get a township, Modimolle, who is for the last 3 months without water. That is what the ANC thinks about black people, Honourable Speaker. Honourable Speaker, hoekom is daar verskeie skole in die Oos-Kaap wat verlede jaar nie 'n enkele leerling deur matriek kon sit nie? Hoe moet hierdie kinders 'n gemeenskappe hoop hê vir 'n beter toekoms? Die ontledingsgroep Africa Check het bevind dat vandat die ANC vir president Zuma aangestel het as staatspresident, is 1,6 miljoen meer Suid-Afrikaners werkloos, agbare spreker. In totaal is daar vandag 8,3 miljoen mense werkloos in Suid-Afrika. Dit is ten spyte van 'n nasionale ontwikkelingsplan, ten spyte van 'n kabinet van 35 ministers en 37 adjunkministers. Werkloosheid, armoede en ongelykheid, dit is die realiteit van 22 jaar van demokrasie onder ANC-regering. Agbare spreker, ons moet as Suid-Afrikaners onsself afvra of die vryheid van die demokrasie 'n werklikheid is vir die gemeenskappe onder ANC-regering. Ons moet vra of mense in Diepsloot, Bushbuckridge en Sebokeng vandag werklik vry is. Het die lewe onder die ANC-regering vir hulle verbeter? Die antwoord is nee. Die vraag is, is daar 'n alternatief? Die antwoord is ja. Die alternatief is die Weskaap onder DA-regering. Ek doen vandag 'n beroep op mense om te kyk na die DA-regering. Vir my is die ou lese, aksie spreek harder as woorde. Met die oog op die komende verkiesing vra ek, kyk na die DA-regering en vergelyk ons met enige ANC-regering. Doen die vergelykings in die armste van die arms gedeeltes. I challenge the Honourable the Yankee, I challenge the ANC, I challenge the people to compare the DA-run province with in every ANC-run province, because there can be no doubt that the Western Cape today provides the poorest amongst us with the highest access to water, to flush toilets, to electricity in the country, Honourable Speaker. Honourable Speaker, consider good governance and accountability, which are key to the democratic democracy, order, as stated by the Premier last week. In 2009, last year, the ANC government governs. In 2009, the last year the ANC governs in the Western Cape, the Auditor General reported that not a single provincial government department received a clean audit. Honourable Speaker, this year 12 out of the 13 departments got clean audits and 13 departments got unqualified audits. Die ANC probeer vandag sê daar is nie waarde in 'n skoon audit nie. Wat 'n skande, Honourable Speaker. Honourable Speaker, yes,
order,
maybe.
Minister, please take your seat. Honourable Dianki, jy het nou jou kans gehad om kole te gooi en die minister het geluister. Asseblief, jy het 'n spreekbeurt gehad. Interjections are allowed, but not a running commentary, please.
Honourable Speaker, the ANC, when they governed in 2009, they ran into the streets with brown envelopes, trying to bribe the reporters, trying to bribe the newspapers. But let me tell them what the clean order do tell the people out there. A clean order tell the people out there the DA don't steal their money. A clean order tell the people out there that we spend their money according to the rule of law, Honourable Speaker. Their money is in safe hands. Die werklikheid is dat die ANC het die Weskaap regeer, Honourable Speaker, en het misluk. Die ANC regeer Suid-Afrika en hulle is besig om te misluk. Agbare Speaker, die DA is die enigste party wat 'n kans gegeen is deur die kiesers om te regeer. En dit is gedoen omdat die DA gewys het, ons is 'n party wat omgee vir die mense. 'n DA wat kwesbare mense eerste stel. 'n DA wat verstaan dat ons mense met hoop gee. 'n DA wat verstaan om mense te kry, moet ons vol hoop vir mense te gee, moet ons 'n volhoubare werk vir hulle gee, nie 'n job opportunity nie. 'n DA wat weet, dis belangrik vir paas en maas om in arm gemeenskappe te kan hoop gee vir hulle kinders se toekoms. Op elke meetbare vlak is die Wes-Kaap 'n beter alternatief vir Suid-Afrikaners. Dit is die provinsie waar ons mense die grootste kans het op 'n beter lewe. Ons verwelkom die mense in die Wes-Kaap, honourable speaker. They welcome in the Western Cape, but we need to also get the funding so that we can provide and build the infrastructure. Agbare speaker, in die Wes-Kaap werk ons elke dag om die gemeenskappe se lewens te verbeter. Dit is die DA se missie om aan elke persoon in hierdie provinsie 'n menswaardige lewe te gee. In die Wes-Kaap droom ons namens ons inwoners en ons droom is dat elke familie volledige dienste erwe moet
hê. Sorry, honourable minister, please take your seat. There's just too much noise coming from the left here. Members, please tone down so that we can hear the speaker. You're drowning out the speaker. You may proceed, Minister. I've just asked for silence. Can we please have silence? You may proceed.
In die Wes-Kaap droom ons namens ons inwoners en ons droom is dat elke familie volledige dienste erwe moet hê, dat elke familie 'n werk moet hê. In die Wes-Kaap het ons 23 van ons 30 munisipaliteite gehelp tot skoon audits, agbare speaker. Ons sit met probleemmunisipaliteite. Ek vra julle, wat het hierdie munisipaliteite in gemeen behalwe dat hulle die sleg bestuurste munisipaliteite in die provinsie is? Kan julle raai? Nie een van hulle word deur die DA bestuur nie. En almal word deur ANC en ANC koalisies bestuur, agbare speaker. Agbare speaker, dinge in Oudtshoorn het so sleg gegaan, ons moet hulle onder administrasie gesit het. Ons skrap vandag nog die gemors uit wat die ANC daar in Oudtshoorn aangevang het. Hierdie provinsie gee meer steun aan ANC en koalisie regerings as aan DA regeerde munisipaliteite, want ons gee om vir die mense wat daar is, agbare speaker. Maar ten spyte van hierdie swak ANC regering daar, gee ons om vir die mense. Dink aan die KKNK wat nie sou plaasgevind het, was dit nie vir die DA se ingryping nie. Wat het gebeur in Eden distrik? Buurmunisipaliteit het hande gevat, geld gegee, ondersteuning gegee sodat die KKNK kan platvind. Dis ongehoord. Jy sal dit nie kry waar die ANC regeer nie, agbare speaker. Die agbare dieentjie noem raadslede wat oortree. Almal het stout kinders. Almal het mense wat oortree, agbare speaker. Aan die agbare dieentjie wil ek sê dat ek sal nie toelaat dat daar op politieke vlak op enige mens se lewe getrap word nie. Ongeag of die raad se ANC, EFF, DA is, hulle sal 'n regverdige verhoor kry. Hulle sal 'n regverdige kans kry om hulle saak te stel. Die verskil is, die DA sal optree teen sy eie mense. Agbare speaker, ek wil vinnig aanraak aan brande. Elke brand is hartseer. Elke lewe wat ons verloor is 'n tragedie. In my span onder rampbestuur kyk ons elke dag en ons werk elke dag om brande te verminder. Deur ons opleidingsprogramme en ons bewusmakingsveldtogte veral onder kinders is besig om geweldige vrugte af te werk. Ons is baie trots op inisiatiewe soos Jerry the Giraffe om die bewusmakingsveldtog te lei en dit is besig om vrugte af te werk. Maar agbare speaker, ek sluit af deur u te herinner dat vanjaar 'n plaaslike verkiesingsjaar is en ek wil graag aan die inwoners van die Wes-Kaap die volgende gedagte los wat ek op 'n onlangs op 'n plakkaat gelees het. Bad politicians are elected by good people who do not vote. Bad politicians are elected by good people who do not vote. U stem kan Suid-Afrika red. Dankie.
Thank you. Order, please, members. I see the Honourable Makwesela.
Honourable Speaker, the Honourable Premier, Ma'am Helen Zille, Honourable Ministers, Honourable Members, Guests, Ladies and Gentlemen, indeed success begets further success. When you hear of the DA story, the term success comes into light. The DA is now the new phrase in the dictionary for success. In her State of the Province address,
order, please.
The Honourable Premier made a number of commitments and indeed exciting pronouncements. Madam Premier, you mentioned in this House last Friday that in the Western Cape, we intend to have other means of alternative energy production, thereby ensuring that 120 extra megawatts is put back into the grid. And that is a good story that nobody else can tell in this country. Madam Premier, you have given hope. We have given leadership. We have given vision to the people of this province. And for that you are saying it is indeed possible that South Africa will be governed under the DA values in our lifetime. When we go to the 2019 elections,
order, please.
We have no doubt that South Africa will indeed have a president, Musimai Mane. Madam Speaker,
Honourable Mark Wasella,
was the ANC.
Please take your seat. There's a member on the floor. Is it a point of
order? Madam Speaker, I honestly didn't hear that. Can the member just repeat it? Because it was too loud.
That is a frivolous point of order, Honourable Mackenzie. You may proceed, Honourable Mark Wasella.
Madam Speaker, indeed, South Africa will be governed by our values. The DA story is here to haunt the ANC, and we will see in 2019 a new president, and that president is Musimai Mane. It has become even more a reality today than ever. In this country, the ANC wants to fire President Zuma more than we think we do need. So even those who are seated on the other side, you don't even believe that Zuma is the correct person to lead us in this country. So that we know.
Order, please.
Let me just say that when I heard Honorable Kyanki speaking about good provinces, I thought I was sitting in another forum. And I can tell you that truth and figures don't lie. We're sitting here with Free State owing Eskom 842 million. We're sitting with Northern Cape owing 2 billion rands. And I can say that is hashtag ANC good governance. That story.
Honorable Marcus.
5.6 billion rands is owed to Eskom nationally. Hashtag ANC good governance. When we speak about corruption, you are sitting here with John Block, who is languishing in dire strain of desperation because the ANC has a good story, hashtag good governance. Humphrey Memezi, Mr. Becker, AKA McDonald's, is sitting in the National Assembly being promoted by you after spending a lot of money of the poor people, hashtag ANC good governance. Becky Kele was speaking in the National Assembly, rubbishing everything good we've done in this province, even lying, saying that we have not spent our money, yet they transferred the budget to us one month before the end of the financial year.
Honorable Mark Wasella.
And we have spent 95% to date, and that is a good story.
Order, please.
Becky Kele is sitting in the National Assembly, having been removed as the police commissioner and promoted for stealing, to become a deputy minister of what? Agriculture, our food security. I wonder he's not going to steal potatoes and bananas.
Honorable Mark Wasella.
Hashtag good,
Honorable Mark Wasella.
Good governance of the ANC.
No, your time's not up. I just needed you to direct your conversation to the chair, please. Thank you. You may continue.
Thank you, Speaker. Hashtag ANC good governance. Now we are sitting here in this province, in a province where at least 23 municipalities had clean audits. But look where they did not get clean audits, because the ANC does not think it's important, you see. Maybe you must tell your ANC national executive there in the cabinet that they must remove the notice, because it's a South African thing which we bought into it, and we are mastering it, because you are the masters of good governance. Go to Cedarburg,
Hashtag ANC good governance. Go to Kanaland. Hashtag ANC good governance. Go to Otsoren. Hashtag ANC good governance. Go to Beaufort West, where the mayor says, I must give you a tender, you must give me money. Because it is the right thing for the ANC. Hashtag ANC good governance. When Balekambete steals money with the corrupt deal with Goldfields, what does he get? What does she get? Promotion to the speaker. Hashtag ANC good governance. I must just clap for you. Hashtag ANC good governance. I'm saying indeed South Africa will be governed under the DA values. And it's a real story. We are an unstoppable tsunami, the blue tsunami, the real story, the real deal for South Africa. Hashtag ANC good governance. In 2015, Madam Speaker, the Speaker of Cape Town asked all parties and all those who represent the society to come and sign a pledge. Listen what this read like. It said, we invite all these political parties to sign and endorse the following objectives on fighting racism. To condemn racism wherever it occurs in Cape Town in all its form, to amplify the voices of the decent majority to reject racism, to build an inclusive Cape Town where human rights are respected. I will stop there. Look who was there. It was all the parties, including PAC, the DA, Cape Muslim Party, UTM. I don't see the name of the ANC, it's missing here. The ANC is the architect of racism in this country. They are the architect of racism, hashtag ANC good governance.
Thank you.
When you had your leader here speaking, Madam Speaker, the leader of the ANC, when he spoke, he ran away now because he can't stand the reality, the truth. When he spoke, when he was finished, Speaker, nobody, they didn't want to stand. They were embarrassed. The chief whip didn't stand. Others also didn't stand. They were trying to pull each other. Stand, man, you see? That is the problem we are facing here. There is no leadership in the ANC. They are boring because this is not a competition we need. We want them to become an effective opposition. We want them to become a party that believes in inclusive society, and they must be able to fight racism in this country, and they failed to unite the people of this country, and we will not stand back. Hashtag good governance of the West.
Can we have some quiet, please, members? We have two more speakers to go, and then we would have got through the session. I now recognize the Honorable Doug Moore.
Thank you very much, Speaker. It is really with a profound sense of disappointment that one listened to the content of the Premier's State of the Province address. Honorable Speaker, what the Premier said and what she did not say explains very clearly why the majority of South Africans, especially black South Africans, I mean colored African and Indian South Africans, working people, the rural poor and women, will never support the Democratic Alliance. This may take
order,
a little bit
please.
More time in the Western Cape because of a deliberate strategy to divide colored and African from white. But the reality is that what is sad about the perspective of the Premier is that one expects the first citizen of the province to give leadership to all in the Western Cape. But given the triple challenges facing our country of inequality, of poverty, and of unemployment, and the fact that the black majority, African and colored people in particular, bear this burden in the main, it is shocking that the Premier's speech did not mention a single word about the following things. Firstly, black economic empowerment. Absolutely nothing. Silence. Secondly, employment equity. Absolutely nothing. And employment equity, for the record, says that historically disadvantaged individuals are colored, are African, are Indian, are women, and the disabled. Not a single word about employment equity. Thirdly,
order,
absolutely
please.
Nothing about preferential procurement. Fourthly, absolutely nothing about changing the patterns of ownership of our economy in this province. Absolutely nothing, fifthly, about the empowerment of women. Absolutely nothing about practical steps to advance and promote economic participation for the jobs and disabled, and absolutely nothing about the demon of racism. Now, this is a premier who is supposed to give leadership to our province, and I want to appeal to every member of this House, and this is very serious, to read the premier's speech again, and then to read the speech of Premier David Makura, who delivered his speech yesterday. And then you will begin to understand the fundamental difference between those in South Africa who understand the need to deal with inequality by actually changing the economic inequality in this country. But the Premier, in her speech, would give the impression, and all of us support the need for job creation, but to argue that simply creating jobs but not dealing with the deep inequalities in our economy reveals exactly what the contradictions in the DA. Why, when Member Mazibuko, the leader of the DA in the opposition, began to talk about the need for employment equity, she was packed away. And now you have a situation where a premier of this province comes into this House and mentions absolutely nothing about employment equity. And this is actually the tragedy that we face, because that then gives a license to managers in this provincial government not to transform their department, so that the Employment Equity Commission in this country has labeled the Western Cape as the worst performing province when it comes to employment equity in the provincial government, because it has got worse since the ANC no longer governs this province. Senior colored, senior women, and senior African managers have actually been marginalized, and their representativity in the senior echelons has actually worsened under the DA, and the facts will speak for themselves. Now, if for instance...
Order, please.
Premier Honourable, Makura
Honourable
did
Dartmoor,
not...
Please speak to the chair. Thank you, if you don't mind.
Premier Makura, Madam Speaker, for instance, did not shy away from talking about racism, and I want to quote him. He said, "Those who call black people baboons are as wrong as those who threaten to drive white students out of university campuses. There must be no room for racists in the South Africa of our dreams," and he proceeds to actually announce measures. But this premier says absolutely nothing about a very serious issue which actually threatens stability in our province. And I think that's the tragedy. We have a situation where this Democratic Alliance is split on the issue of transformation and the need to implement equity. Because you hear one thing from Helen Zille, you hear another thing from Musi Maimani, you hear another thing from Herman Mashaba, and the reality is that the only way this party survives in South Africa and in the Western Cape is to stoke colored fears against African people. And Swart Gevaar is in the interests of the Democratic Alliance, and that's the only way
order,
that they are surviving
please.
In this province. The tragedy is that all of
order,
these
please,
issues,
members.
All of these issues that I'm talking about, of advancement, of equity, of redress, are required by our constitution, but they are completely ignored by the Premier. The tragedy is that when the First Citizen delivers an address which fails to deal with inequality, redress, and transformation, the lead is then followed by many. Our Premier is not leading. In fact, she's making it acceptable for key sectors in our society, in the business community, the agricultural sector, to actually ignore the imperatives of transformation and employment equity. She's ignoring employment equity, she's ignoring the empowerment of women, and she's actually belittling the massive inequality in our province in regard to land ownership, because she is silent on these matters. And while I welcome, and all of us welcome, the need to grow the economy and create jobs, and there's consensus about that, we as the ANC are saying that it is not only possible to grow jobs, but it is possible to both grow jobs and transform the ownership patterns of our economy. And that is essential to the stability of our country, to ensure economic ownership is shared and transformed, because without that, we create a recipe for deepened inequality and deepened conflict. And that's the tragedy, because her speech talks to jobs alone, but does not talk to the fundamental inequality that we need to address. And the Premier's economic plans, Madam Speaker, are in fact a recipe or a blueprint to maintain the patterns of economic privilege in the Western Cape. And this is dangerous, because when, for instance, you, MEC Madikizela, and MEC Grant announce the better living model, and you put this in the newspaper, nowhere in this advert is any of the criteria around broad-based black economic empowerment. Absolutely not. So it's about maintaining and preserving privileges in regard to land ownership and in opportunity, because you do not actually insist. And then if we, for instance, have to compare that, if we compare that to David Makura, our Premier in Gauteng, he says, to us, nothing is such a permanent reminder of our apartheid and colonial past than the persistent racial exclusion of blacks from the mainstream of the economy. This is not language the Premier uses. Why? Because she represents the maintenance of privilege. You go on to Premier Makura, and he, for instance, says very clearly that as the pioneers...
Order, please. Honourable Dagmo, kindly take your seat, please. Members, we cannot throw insults across the floor while there's a speaker addressing us. Can I please ask that both sides of the House contain yourselves and allow Honourable Dagmo to proceed? You may proceed.
The stark contrast between essentially ANC policy and leadership and DA maintenance of white privilege is the following. David Makura says, I truly believe we can use procurement policy to achieve genuine black economic empowerment in all sectors without bribery and corruption. We must get rid of the perception that any black person who gets a tender has bribed his or her way into the corridors of power. And this is important. Let us empower black people, contractors, construction companies, law firms, accounting and audited firms, engineering, consulting firms, emerging farmers and manufacturers of food products, industrialist entrepreneurs, unashamedly, transparently and ethically. And this is simply what you do not get from this DA government, and why they are so divided in regard to things. And, Madam Speaker, the issue we have then is a Premier who undermines the very redress and equity and equality that our Constitution demands of us. And what is in fact even more scandalous is that in this province we have a Premier who actually ignores the provisions of the Provincial Constitution, which has been certified, whatever the debates were, and this Constitution, which is the law in this country, in this province, requires the Western Cape to set up a Children's Commissioner and to set up an Environmental Commissioner. And what we had, and the honourable members of that side of the House will tell you, that throughout the province there was support for setting up a Children's Commissioner and an Environmental Commissioner, and despite a promise made by the Premier in 2009, nothing has been done. In fact, what the Premier tried to do last year was that she tried to get an amendment to the Constitution to actually make it not compulsory to appoint these. And what it is that they want to avoid the focus on our children who are suffering from tick, on our children who are being abused on the farms. They don't want a commissioner to highlight those things. They don't want an environmental commissioner to expose the deals of the mayor and others who are involved in property deals. They don't want that truth to where they're riding roughshod, and they don't want an environmental commissioner to investigate where the DA, through people like MEC Bradell and that, collect their money from developers in this province for overriding. That is the reality which they don't want. And the other thing that we have seen very, very clearly is this attempt to try and paint, as the Premier did, through distortions and deliberate untruths, is to paint a picture that this province is penalised when it comes to the provision of South African police service. Let me inform this House of official statistics that when one looks at the ratio of a police person to the general population, the Western Cape is actually in the third best position in the country. Yes, the The Northern Cape has one police person to 184. The Free State has one person to 240, one police person to 243. The Western Cape has one to 304. And all the other provinces, and the worst of which is in fact Limpopo at one police person to 481. But the Premier will come to this House using figures selectively and saying in a certain police station you have one to 600. The reality is the Western Cape is the third best provided when it comes to police persons in the country. It is. The challenge, however, Madam
Order,
Speaker,
please.
Is that we need to focus on those inequalities which Honourable Member Wenger referred to of Nyanga compared to Camps Bay. Yes, but instead of actually focusing and working with the police to deal with those inequalities, the Premier has decided to fight the national government. But don't come to this House. Don't come to this House and create an impression that the Western Cape is being penalised when it comes to the provisioning of police. It is simply not consistent with the facts. And Member Wenger can go to Parliament and get the official response to a parliamentary question to get this particular information.
Order, please, members.
MEC Nombombo and the Premier want to come and boast about health provision in this province. And do you know that the Auditor General has investigated, and we want that to see the results of that investigation, that the Department of the Health in the Western Cape is paying private practitioners 60,000 rand a month to spend 1 hour a week at a clinic in Slangrivier. 1 hour a week. That is a complete abuse of public resources, actually subsidizing the private sector. And I challenge you, MEC, to come and reveal the truth about what was the procurement process followed to appoint those two general practitioners, how much were they paid each month, and how many hours they spent in the community. And here we want to have this side of the House rubbishing the national health insurance system, whereas public
Order,
funds
please,
are being used
members.
To actually fund. And I think this is what we actually need to focus on. So we have a Premier who talks about focusing on the youth for the next 3 years, but simply
finish up.
In a particular style of preserving privilege and patronage, actually does not talk to transformation, does not talk. And that is why the African National Congress, despite our challenges, will continue to be the hope for the majority, black, African, and coloured, and those people from the white community who are serious about changing inequality. Thank you.
Thank you. Members, can we please just all calm down? There's a little bit. I will allow those members to be seated. I now recognize the Honourable Minister, Minister Wundi.
Thank you very much, Speaker. Thank you very much. Speaker, we are in a debate here in this province following the state of the provincial address as given by the Premier last week. That also followed on the State of the Nation address as given by the President. And what are we dealing with here? We're dealing with a State of the Nation address that was given by the President to a state where people are disillusioned, people are hungry, there's no plan, our economy is going down the toilet. That's the State of the Nation that the President had to give. And in this province, the
Order,
State of the
please.
Province address given by the Premier on Friday was a state of the province by a leader who gave hope, exactly correct, who gave hope to the people of this province. And here we are today. Today is actually that day in this province where the opposition gets to open the debate. This is the day when the alternative government in this province has the opportunity to talk about this province, the state of this province. This is when the newly elected Ngaka as the leader of the opposition in this province has his opportunity to make his mark. Guess what he does? He walks out. But you know where he's gone to, Madam Speaker? He's gone outside to address the masses. I apologize if I laughed too loudly when I saw this photograph. I wish I could put it on the screens. This is the photograph of the masses outside this very legislature that the Honourable Ngaka has gone to go and address. There are more spectators than ANC people standing outside there. It's a blooming pathetic show. This is the new leader of the opposition. This is your day in the opposition to come with the alternative. You know that this debate is the debate where we're going to an election in a few months in this province. This is the debate where the ANC in this province will stand up and brag about all of their accomplishments where they govern, so that they can convince the people like that are standing outside there that they need to vote for the ANC because they are so good at governing in this province. They are the alternative. I never heard one word from one member in these benches say one thing or brag about one item of where they govern. Hashtag bad ANC government in this province. Not good ANC government in this province. Not one showcase, nothing. And then, of course, one by one, people stand up and they start to use statistics. And it's actually amazing. And I, you know, they fall into the trap because they do mention the year of the statistics every now and again. That's why I was asking the Honourable Dugmore if the statistics he was using was 2011, because it was one of the common statistics that we heard in the room today. And perhaps while he's answering me on that, I hope he's actually read the Khayelitsha Commission report. Because if you go and read that report, Honourable Dugmore, you will see exactly where the disproportionate allocation is by the police that you are talking about in this province.
Order, please.
You will see that it is skewed, and you have done nothing, zero, and it's your ANC government that runs this portfolio at a national level. You've done zero about trying to fix it. You, the one that says you're interested in the people of this province, zero, nothing, naught, nada.
Honourable Minister, can I caution you, please speak to the chair and manage that finger, please. Thank you.
I'll try, thank you, Madam Speaker. I'll hold these documents then in my hand. So, Madam Speaker, we heard many statistics, and I'm going to start with the statistics as used by the Honourable Ngaka, who's the now leader of the opposition in this province. And he very, very cleverly followed on all of the previous people that have spoken before him. You remember Fransman? He used to be the leader of the opposition. You remember him, don't you? He used to be here. He's now no longer. But exactly the same thing. Chacham, not so long ago, the Honourable Chacham was talking about statistics and specifically something called the Gini coefficient. And of course, we heard the Honourable Janki, who's now also left. You all heard him say that today, wach vir Dinsdag, dis die dag. I mean, I've never heard such a pathetic speech in my life. We were all waiting in anticipation for this absolutely powerful speech coming from him, and he's left. I mean, there was nothing to it, but he did mention some statistics. He did mention... okay,
order,
so they've
please.
Gone up to 31 people outside now. But each and every person start mentioning statistics. Now, when we govern, we have to use mechanisms of measurement to govern by, and you heard the Premier mention a whole lot of them, and you've heard many speakers speak about the impact. You've spoken about the audit outcomes. Here the audit outcomes are for the country. Have a look at all the red marks in the rest of the country, and look at the green marks in this province. But I'm not going to speak about it because many speakers have spoken about it. But the main thing that the Auditor General speaks about over and above this is a number called 30 billion. 30 billion that disappears or can't be accounted for in this country just in the last financial year. If you add that all together, you're looking at something like 750 billion over the last 20 years that cannot be accounted for. Is that a government looking after the interests of the poor in this country? It's not a thumbsuck. The Auditor General. And
order,
imagine if
please.
We add that to the 500 billion that the Honourable Grant was speaking about in his speech that after some musical chairs with the President on what has leaked out of this country. We are facing budget cuts because there's no tax income, there's no confidence in the system in South Africa. And is that good governance? Is that making this country... governing this country and leading this country according to a good plan and good, strong political leadership in the interests of the poor people of this country? I say it does not. Hashtag bad ANC government. So let's talk about, and I know the Honourable, and
order,
I know the Honourable
please.
Wenger spoke about these measurements, but I brought this to the House specifically because the Honourable Leader of the Opposition, the Honourable Fransman also spoke about it, the Honourable Chacham spoke about it, and the Honourable Janki spoke about it, about the most unequal place in South Africa. Absolutely wrong, and it's been double-checked, the first time by following Fransman's statement, and it actually says here, Fransman said on the 16th of June 2012, he said at a youth trade, how does Zille claim to be the best premier when it's the most unequal city in the world? They came back and said, absolutely wrong, and there the numbers are. You know, the Gini coefficient measured from 0 to 1, and of course, we must always say that in this city and in this province, we will continually work to bring that number down because it is too high, and that's why we do what we do, and that's why we apportion the budgets that we do. But the lowest in South Africa. It goes on to say that Fransman didn't know what he was talking about. They then did a further study, and the Honourable Wenger spoke about it. United Nations says East London, Johannesburg, and the East Rand are the most unequal cities, not in South Africa, in the world. In the world. This is where hashtag bad ANC governs. This is totally unacceptable. Then let's have a look at the other statistics that are used in this debate, and we come to the jobs numbers. And it is actually quite interesting because I heard often from two speakers from the ANC today where they would speak about this quarter, they would speak about 2011, they would mix up the numbers. We mustn't mix up the numbers. We must have a look in five-year terms of when governments were in power, because that's how the voters have to then vote on according to your plans and how you delivered on your plans. If you've got a plan, because quite frankly, we don't see the National Development Plan featuring anywhere in these processes. It just gets spoken about every couple of years. But if you look at the stats of the jobs numbers, and we measure 2009 to 2015, and we have a look at South Africa. And in South Africa over that period, not to 2011, to 2015, there were 1.251 million extra jobs created in this country. Way too low. We need more growth so we can create many, many more jobs. Because the scary thing is that in the unemployed in South Africa, we're sitting at 5.418 million. But not economically active, 14.68 million, and discouraged workers a further 2.26 million. That's 22 million people who are not participating in the economy of this country. That's at a national level. If we look at the 1.2 million jobs that were created in South Africa, in this part of the country, which is 13, well, it's now 14, it's going better. We're actually becoming a bigger part of South Africa's economy. We were 13, we're now 14.7% of South Africa's economy. We brought in 27% of the jobs in this province. 27. It has the highest labor force participation rate of 68%. Gauteng at 52% and declining. That is the capital of the economy in South Africa and declining. So what happens? What happens? Do you want to move to Gauteng? It sounds like you do. But the Premier mentioned the Business Confidence Index. Have a look at what's happening. The Johannesburg Stock Exchange are opening an office in Cape Town. Why? Because their customers are in Cape Town. This is where the economy is moving to. I spoke last year about is Gauteng going to lose the economic capital of South Africa as by MoneyWeb? And so what happens is these things are changing in this province. Why? Because the Premier puts an address out that creates hope, that shows the report card of what this province did over the last year while we've been in government. It's the state of the province that creates hope. So then let's have a look at something else. And now,
order, please.
And now, if you'll allow me, because we're talking about the state of the nation and the state of the province, I found it quite interesting when the president spoke in the State of the Nation address, and he said, South Africa to focus on financial service skills development. We need to become the financial hub of Africa. And quite frankly, we do. I've spoken about it in this house before, and we've seen what's happening in Mauritius, how they really are doing amazing things. But it's quite interesting. He announces a program in the State of the Nation address, and it's almost word for word. The financial skills shortage is critical. Province intervenes to meet demand on the 26th of March 2014. It was a project that was launched by me in Gauteng in partnership with UCT, Barclays Africa Group, First Rand, Liberty, We launched the African Institute of Financial Markets and Risk Management. It was already launched in March 2014. So again, this province taking the lead, but we'll give the president the opportunity to announce it again, and we will definitely work with him because I do believe that that's what we've got to do. So,
order,
I'm
please.
Getting there. Just relax. I'm getting there. So now let's also talk about something else that's come up in the debate. And that is this constant talk about national government and provincial government and national money and provincial money. And we need to respect our national colleagues, etc. We commit permanently to work with our national colleagues. But it has to work both ways. It has to work both ways. So what happens? What happens? Last Friday, while we were all sitting here, there was a little thing that happened in Knysna, where the human settlement minister, Lindiwe Sisulu, goes and does a big land handover. And it says, Knysna land deal, not an election ploy. It says, not an election
order,
ploy.
Order, please.
And you've just heard the Honourable Doug Moore say, together with your mayor. The mayor was here. The mayor was here. This was full of ANC T-shirts, but it says not an election ploy. The same thing the Premier spoke about. The Premier spoke. The Premier
Members,
spoke about sorry, Minister Becky Cayley.
Minister, please, can you take your seat for just a minute? I'm sorry to stop you in your tracks. There's too much noise, members, from both sides of the House. Can I please appeal for silence so that we can afford the minister an opportunity to present? You may proceed, Minister Windy.
The Minister, Becky Cayley, also made a whole lot of statements in Parliament last week. I've written a letter to him, and let's see what he replies. But for one, where he spoke about his visit to Swartland Municipality, where there was 157 participants in a project, and now there's only 14. We've actually searched through the whole space. We cannot find this project. He spoke about the flood money, which the Premier spoke about, where he says that we only spent 5%. I cannot even go back to any of the reporting that says 5%. You go to the different reporting, the lowest number I can find is 25%, but you must understand that when you get given the money, you cannot just spend it. You've got to go through processes. Well, this government talks about good government and processes.
Minister Wendy, please finish up.
When you understand those processes, the environmental authorization and water license approvals had still not been handed out to us. So, Madam Speaker, I gather when you
your
said...
Your time has expired.
Does that mean what?
Yes, sorry. Your last, your closing sentence.
Last closing sentence, Madam Speaker. I would like to follow on the Honourable Mkasele to say #bad ANC government in South Africa.
That, Honourable Members, concludes the debate on the Premier's State of the Province address. The Honourable Premier will reply to the debate on Thursday, the 25th of February 2016, in this House at 2:15. I thank you. The House is adjourned.